Meeting has, will be called to order as it is 7 o'clock. I believe we are on live TV tonight. I don't have the script in front of me, but...
Oh, yeah.
RCTV, and there's a website. I don't have it memorized, so I'm sure you've all been on it before. The first item on the agenda is the tree removal policy discussion. And I think some of us reviewed it and have given you new comments, Chuck. Dave and I were speaking and talking about it prior to when you came in. And he thought on the second page, the end of the hazard tree thing, you've got emergency certification procedures in the state and town. Could you put the regs or where they could find that information?
Okay.
And then, on the next page, under the hazardous tree protocol, under 2, you've got qualified professional and maybe in parentheses, a licensed arborist. Because I don't think we'd want anybody to misconstrue that that might be a landscaper. Because I wouldn't trust a landscaper per se to look at a tree and, you know, be able to...
Arborist license?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Pretty sure they are.
When we get a letter, I thought they'd just say, I've been an arborist for this many years, I didn't know they had a license as well.
I know that landscape architects do.
Yeah.
I wonder though, if it's, we talked about this a little bit the other day. So the reason that we left it a little bit more broad was in an emergency, you might not be able to get an arborist out there.
Well, that's, that, the previous page allows, if you've got a tree or a limb hanging, that allows you to go in and address it without having a professional.
Okay.
Is that not the intent of that piece, those two paragraphs on page 2, Chuck? Would you be able to, if you had something that was going to fall on your house, would you be able to go in using...
You need to, always need permission, but it gives me permission to allow up to two trees to be taken down if I...
Okay.
Qualified it.
Okay. And that's that first paragraph under the hazard trees.
Yeah.
So is that okay?
Excellent.
Great stuff.
I like the fact that I thought that the 250 to 500 for residential properties was reasonable, and I like the idea that under commercial projects that was left open. Because we could be talking about lots of trees. If it was, you know, something like a Johnson Woods where it was all wooded and, you know, maybe there would be some other kind of mitigation that they'd be able to provide.
Yeah.
So I did like that. What about the rest of the members of the commission?
I think it's good.
Yep.
I think it's good.
Do we need to vote on this?
Certainly do.
Okay.
Is this the final draft?
So I guess what Chuck passed around, I made some minor comments. I guess it never got around to everybody. Yeah, the only thing that I was looking to really replace was that was not really anything from a approach, just from wording I want. Rather than saying 100 feet of a wetland or 200 feet of river, anything that's in our jurisdiction. And then I just ended up calling it a replacement ratio. I think in a couple places we call it one-to-one ratio, one-to-one ratio. The reality is, you know, it's not always a one-to-one ratio. Our table isn't necessarily representative of that either. So I didn't want to give the wrong impression that it's always one-to-one. You know, I think that if we just say a replacement ratio, the table speaks for itself after the fact. So those were the only two edits that I had.
I myself would rather see the 100 and 200 feet left in there.
Uh-huh.
because this is not for us, it's for the general public to read and follow.
Sure.
So I think it's important to leave that kind of detail in there.
I think that's fine.
My only question on the one-to-one is that, you know, I think the way this is going to be administrated would be that there's going to be at least one tree would be either planted or paid for.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, it's, you know, it could change. So do you think you've covered that with what your changes are?
Yeah, I think all we're saying is, rather than saying a one-to-one ratio, we're just calling it replacement ratio. You know, it's one tree or two bushes or two or three, back to whatever the table is on that, you know, three shrubs, 3 and 3 foot in height, or two large shrubs, 5 to 6 feet in height. You know,
like David just said, I think that one-to-one is pretty clear. People will understand that instead of trying to figure out what the ratio is, so.
But that's the problem, is one-to-one's clear, so we say it's a one-to-one ratio, and then we say now you need to replace it with three. That's something very different. This table is clear that it's not a one-to-one ratio.
Yeah, it was written as one-to-one before we put the table in.
Yeah.
I think the way
how about at least one-to-one?
I think just label it as the title block for that line in the table, I think is correct with you saying replacement ratio.
Yeah.
I do agree with that.
Or in accordance with the replacement tree and shrub schedule below?
Yeah. I think that's fine. Just as long as, you know, I think that just makes it clear. The table stands for itself. I think
okay.
That's clear.
All right. Is everybody in agreement with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have those changes, Joe?
I don't. But I'm hoping you're going to write them on your page.
Sure.
Send them over to me. I'm going to just do this notes here.
Yeah. Stipulate the regulations and the license records. Okay, do I have a motion?
I make a motion to accept the Reading Conservation Commission tree replacement policy as amended at this meeting.
Wait a second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Sorry.
Abstain? Okay. All right. It's 7:08, and we have, Chuck, I'm going to change the schedule a little bit. We have a proposal, a Boy Scout proposal project in the town forest, and I would like this gentleman to come forward and tell us about your project.
I do. Hi, I'm Harrison Biscus, part of Boy Scout Troop 702, located just across the street from the church. Attempting to do my Eagle project this upcoming fall. I was thinking around end of October, early November, and it's in the town forest, one of the map right now. It borders some conservation land, but I think it's on a physical trail already. I'd be building a boardwalk in an area that's, during parts of the year, it's almost impassable because of mud and flooding. As you can see from the presentation, I have an arrow to where it'd be. It's in the very back. It's right near, there's this old piece of farming machinery back there.
So
I don't know if that helps
picture.
Identify it. But that's where, that's the area that I have proposed. I've talked to the Trails Committee and the Town Forest Committee. They've both approved. I've taken into the consideration things, guidelines they've given me. If you want to click to the next slide, that'd be great. That's just another shot, and then, next one. So that's the condition that the trail's in earlier this spring. Mind you, that was after a very weak winter. You can only imagine a more severe winter with a lot of snowmelt, the flooding that's gonna happen back there. And then the last one.
Sure.
So this is the proposed boardwalk. It's 56 feet long with the ramps on the side. The ramps will make it easier for cross-country skiers as well as anyone who wants just easier access up and off of the bridge. Thoughts, comments?
Chuck, is this the same design that we have approved?
Yes.
Previously?
Mm-hmm.
And we had another gentleman from, I believe your troop, come in last spring, maybe? And he was on that, he designed that and built that trail from the council up to Wood End School.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, Anika, do you have any questions?
How wide is the boardwalk?
I think it says it.
I'm sorry, I can't read it.
Yeah.
5 feet?
I think it's a little shorter than 5 feet. Might be five. Yeah, it is.
Oh, great.
You're right.
Great. I know in the past, and I'm not necessarily suggesting this, but I do know in the past, I'll just mention that there have been wooden edges.
Yeah, there's
put on
wheelchair accessible ledges, but if you get back there with a wheelchair, that's one thing.
Well,
I know.
It would be more for cross country ski. Or,
yeah, we're definitely going to include that in the final design.
You are, okay, all right. And is it probably is jurisdictional wetlands?
I do not believe so.
It's just a slightly mucky area.
I haven't been out there.
Do you have a sense?
To look at this.
This is at the bottom of a really steep hill.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so it might be just a groundwater discharge point.
Yeah, I would expect it to be pretty muddy back there.
Pretty muddy. Okay. So yeah, I mean that will definitely keep erosion of the trail
mm-hmm.
down to a minimum and enhance the enjoyment during winter and,
yep.
and wetter seasons. So I don't have any issue with.
I have two questions. So the 4x4s you're putting in the ground. How far down do they go? Is it you just hammer them until they stop?
So they're 8 feet long. We're gonna, like you said, hammer or bam them in as far as they go, and then cut off the excess. The boardwalk from the bottom of it will be a foot off the ground.
Okay.
That way animals and water can pass through.
Okay.
So yeah, hammer that down as far as we can go.
Hit it till it stops moving. Okay.
Yeah.
And then can you go back to the top map? I was just curious, the proposed trail going from Great Island towards Main Street, sort of the, what do we call that? The future trail that would walk along the Ipswich River? Is this consistent with that?
I know this trail's already been there in the past. I'm not
sure.
So
this trail's already there.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Any other questions from the commission?
Yeah, I had a question. Are you building the sections on site or bringing them in?
We'd be building on site.
So are you going to bring out a lot of material and leave it there over
right.
the course of a couple of weeks, or is this going to
plan on doing it all in one weekend?
One weekend,
yes.
Okay. How close can you bring the material with your vehicles and then?
I know the trail is vehicle accessible all the way back to the main part of it, like right here, and then we'd have to bring it down that steep.
How many feet? It's not that far.
Not that far, 50 feet max.
Oh, that's not bad.
Are there any questions from the audience?
Just one more question. The end of the two ends of the boardwalk, I understand you're going to be trying to get that flush with the ground.
So yeah, Trails Committee recommended that I put a ramp there for cross-country skiing, and that would we'd then bury it, like you said, flush with the ground.
All right. So when you're building it, you have to avoid roots? And if you encounter a root, are you just going to make it a little bit bigger or smaller to, so you don't have to chop it out of the way?
Yeah, we would go around it.
Okay. Great.
Chuck, do we have a sign-in sheet for the back?
Yeah, I just started.
I got
to put it out there.
I got it.
Thanks, Mike. Okay. This is under the Trails Committee I think, general permit, right?
It is.
So we don't need to make a vote, do we?
You can vote to approve the project.
Right. Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to approve the project as presented in the town forest for the ramp over the wet spot as indicated.
I second it.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Okay, being after 7:10, we have the town of North Reading, Engineering Department, Mike Soren. Town of North Reading has been doing some bridge work on Mill Street. And did I get the right last name?
Sorrigan,
I'm sorry.
That's fine.
Would you like to?
I prepared a statement I'd like to read, just, you know, and it, based upon our conversation yesterday, it's, you know, some background of the project and
certainly
know, what how we'd like to go forward. But I'm Mike Sorrigan. I'm the town engineer with the town of North Reading. I've been town engineer over there for approximately 18 years. In other words, I was there when the deck of that bridge was replaced back in 1998. Anyways, I'm appearing before the Reading Conservation Commission as a result of an enforcement audit dated August 31st, 2016. The audit was issued for not filing with the Reading Conservation Commission for work in an area subject to protection under the Wetlands Protection Act and the Town of Reading's Wetland Protection Bylaw, as well as failure to obtain a permit for work in a resource area and altering a resource area. Approximately 1 year ago, I received a call requesting repairs be made to the bridge by a resident of Reading. Her concern was focused on the instability of some large granite blocks on the North Reading side of the bridge. I had a discussion with George Zamboris, the former Reading town engineer, to let him know I did receive this request and we would investigate it. Based upon a site visit, I felt it would be advantageous to seek out a qualified engineer to conduct a complete bridge inspection. MassDOT agreed to send out one of their teams to provide the town of North Reading with some technical assistance. MassDOT provided the town with a report dated August 19, 2015, which I have a copy that I will present to the board. Since the bridge is considered off-system and locally owned, it's my understanding that it's joint ownership between Reading and North Reading. Any deficiencies reported were considered the responsibility of the bridge owners, the towns of North Reading and Reading. Two areas of concern on the North Reading side were located on the northeast and northwest wing walls. The northeast wing wall especially was pointed out that there was a potential for failure of the approach slab. Numerous chinking stones needed to be replaced in various structural elements, whether they be the abutments or the breast walls or the center pier. The repair to the northeast wing wall was supposed to have been completed as part of the 1998 project. This project had been designed, permitted, and constructed with resources from both towns. However, it either had never been done or it had fallen into disrepair again as a result of several flooding events over the last 18 years. Regardless, it was our intention to make repairs to that part of the bridge. The town of North Reading contacted one of our consultants, the engineer of record for the 1998 repairs, Green International Affiliates, to prepare some sketch plans to accompany our application to the North Reading Conservation Commission and provide some direction to our contractor. A request for determination of applicability was filed with the North Reading Conservation, accompanied by the green sketch plans, a narrative, and an amended site plan originally prepared by the Reading Town Engineer for the 1998 A&R filing for bridge repairs, showing the location of the work. A negative 3 determination was given to the project by the North Reading Conservation Commission. It should be pointed out also that the town of Redding's town manager office had received notification of the public hearing through a notice that was hand-delivered by me to the town manager's office. I also know that North Redding Town Administrator sent a few emails to the town manager, letting him know we were going to be working on the bridge. The town of North Redding initiated work through its contractor, TZE Inc., on the bridge in August 2016, under my direction and a structural engineer from Green International Affiliates. The northeast wing wall has been repaired completely, and some chinking has been done prior to receiving the enforcement order. Upon receipt of this order, we agreed to stop all work at the end of the day, September 1st, 2016, and all conditions set forth in the order have been complied with. It's our position that no damage was done to the resource area as a result of our work. The town of North Redding is seeking to complete the repairs highlighted in the inspection report. This would involve mostly chinking and repairs to the northwest press wall if possible. All work, including staging of materials, would be limited to the North Redding side of the bridge, outside the resource area. No work is proposed within the town of Redding, and no equipment will be allowed within the stream bed, and all equipment will stay in the town of North Redding. If the enforcement order is removed, we would commence work Tuesday, October 11th, 2016, weather permitting. Work would be complete by Wednesday, October 13th, October 13th, 2016. At least 24 hours notice will be given to the town of Redding Conservation Agent, Chuck Barone, prior to resuming work. I'll answer any questions.
Okay. It came to our attention last meeting. Members of the Historical Commission were here, and there is Redding, town of Redding land on the north side of that Mill Street Bridge, on either side, pretty significant parcels. So I guess where are you going to store your equipment if it's going to be in North Redding? Is it going to be on the road itself, or?
Right away, on the road.
Okay.
It will be taken away, it will be driven away from the site at the end of the day.
Okay. And where are you storing your materials?
We'd bring them to the site on a daily basis.
You've got more concrete to put into the the walls, right? That chinking process?
Yes, it's just basically pieces of granite that are wedged in against the larger blocks.
And where are you going to break that granite up? Because previously you did break it up in the stream bed.
I understand. It would be in the right way, on the street.
On the street. And how are you going to protect the asphalt?
Let's stir it over there.
It's what?
Yeah. Where they were parked, that's a dirt area.
Oh, okay.
So maybe they can just stack it up and smash it on top of each other.
Yeah.
Any questions from the commission?
I have a question just from the how we got to this spot. You said, I think you had mentioned you hand-delivered the public notice to the town manager, or there's some communication. Is it typically done in North Reading that usually any butter is getting certified mail with slips? Do you guys do that as well, or?
There weren't that many butters to the project, and it was just as easy for me to hand deliver, the notices to the residents of Mill Street and the town.
I just want to make a comment, and I want this to go on the record, is that anytime you're doing any work within 100 feet of a resource area, you need to notify the abutter somehow, either a request for determination or a notice of intent or something. in compliance with the Wetlands Protection Act and in this case, our Reading General Bylaws. I'm just going on record and saying it. If I were doing this work, I certainly would have done it.
If I had to do it over again, I definitely would do that.
I mean, in the future, I just want to make sure we are notified when something's occurring, that the town is notified, if whether it's this project or any other project that.
Was there any thought that you were, that whole bridge was North Reading? Was that a
no.
Is, okay.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
No, I sort of refer back to the 1998 project where the bridge deck was replaced and how that was permitted.
I have a question.
I don't know how that was permitted, but.
So I have a question. So when you spoke to the Reading engineer, did Mr. Zimboris give you any idea of, did anybody that you spoke with at Reading along the way give you any notice that you need to talk to conservation? Or did, I mean, because it's unclear to me whether you understood in your communications with Reading whether that information was going to get passed on to us just implicitly.
Based upon my conversations with the town engineer in Reading, our conversation was limited to the structural elements.
And the project aspects.
And the project aspects.
Yeah.
And any deficiencies that were on the North Reading side.
Yeah.
You know, I explained to him I'd be following up. I'd be doing due diligence and making the repairs if necessary.
And
but there was no conversation.
And the same sort of goes with the town manager's office? Or was there a conversation had there, or was it simply
I just left the notice there.
Yeah.
And, you know, knowing how towns work, I probably shouldn't have done that because it probably sat on somebody's desk for a couple of days and then was buried with paper or, you know. I'm not saying I handled it correctly.
I said
to the chairman, if I had to do it over again, I would do it.
Yeah, I understand.
So now you know.
I guess, yeah, my interest is just, you know, in these miscommunication or misunderstanding situations, I really like to try and understand where the lapse occurred so that it can be repaired, you know, so that in the future the communication flows more freely and more easily for the next project, because nobody wants, nobody wants to irritate other groups of towns or other towns or other entities within town. We all want to work together, and we all want it for the greater good of the community. So that was just what I was getting at.
In my own defense, when Chuck and the current town engineer came to the site and made some comments, I think we responded quickly to correct the situation.
Yeah.
You know, I think we've always had pretty good relationships with the town of Reading, and you know, it didn't take much more than a few words from Chuck to get us to
I think if there was any, in this particular project, if there was any upfront communication or like pre-planning done cooperatively, we might have been able to have cooperatively done work on both sides of that potentially. If there were, I don't know exactly the list of repairs on our side of that same bridge, you know, but you know, it could have been a real chance for that. So next time.
Any other Chuck?
So I just want to make sure that I know you said that there was no alteration there, but I just want to make sure that, and I'm not sure that the Wetlands Protection Act and our town bylaw, you know, is fully understood by North Reading. So we captured you under the clause that, you know, there's no problem until, so there's not a problem until there is a problem. So when I went out there and I saw that granite block in the stream bed in that work area right there, that's alteration. That's fill in a resource area, whether it's temporary or not, it shouldn't be there. I mean, right in the Ipswich River is just too sensitive to have that happen. I also didn't see anyone there but the two people working on the job, and I understand they know their job, but they don't know the environmental job. And I was surprised at how the site was and how sensitive it was and how no one was there to watch them and keep things like that with the cement in the stream bed, you know, I guess not happening. And then there was the boulders being used. So anything in the stream bed that they needed to repair their project. And I think that's the most troubling, because that's definitely direct alteration of the stream bed. And I know that your administrator said that she had no problem with the work going on there and with the work that was in that stream bed. And I just simply disagree. But there's some other things that needed to happen. Since Reading is a landowner in the North Reading side and a direct abutter, it's quite possible that you were working on North Reading land or Reading's land and you're outside the right of way. So it's quite possible we needed to sign the original application, and it's probably, in my opinion, we should have received the determination as the landowner that you were working next to, so they would be fully aware of what happened. So just to emphasize that's in the Wetlands Protection Act. You have to do that. And for all those reasons, to have this covert operation going on out in the back 40 of Reading and North Reading, when it really could have been a team effort to have that thing, team effort between both commissions, both towns, the Historic Commission, everyone that would understand that project. So for once and for all, with, you know, one disturbance in a great time of year when they had no water flowing through there, we could have got everything done. So it wasn't just the fact that, hey, we're on our side, so why are you bothering us? It wasn't that at all. It needed to be addressed, and it was a little bit shocking when I went out there. So I just felt like saying that, and it really is a response to what Leah Basbane said to me when I was out at the bridge. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Jack.
Are there any comments, questions from the audience? And your name, please.
I'm Gina Snyder. I live on Datum Terrace, and I've been a volunteer with the Ipswich River Watershed Association for many years, monitoring that bridge monthly. That is a very unique habitat. It's a riffle area. USGS did a study, and it's one of the very few riffle areas. And they've removed boulders from that riffle area, and that was truly inappropriate. I was very upset to see the disturbance in the riverbed. North Reading may not realize the amount of money, effort, and volunteer time that's gone into preserving the Ipswich River on the Reading side. So I would just like to emphasize what you've been saying about how upsetting it is to have had this happen. I also would like to encourage the town of Reading to have better internal communications. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Jonathan Barnes. I'm a Reading resident and a member of the Reading Historical Commission. I appreciate your being here this evening. I appreciate the opportunity before the Conservation Commission, and I appreciate your candor with respect to this project. I would just want to mention that in addition to this area being significant and important, because it is obviously within the jurisdiction of the conservation area, I'm sure you're aware as the town engineer and in North Reading, that this area is also registered not only with the town of Reading, but with the state Massachusetts Historical Commission under state law as a archaeological historical significant site. It's registered on that inventory, and it is therefore, and that site, by the way, and I recognize that this is on the border of Reading and North Reading, but that is a state law and a state agency, and I realize that the fact that it's on the border may have some sensitivity with respect to obligations. And I would also want to express, I am perhaps as disappointed in the lack of communication from the town of Reading to those of us who also are involved in town affairs. But I'm also disappointed with respect to the town of Reading. Under the state law that governs the Massachusetts Historical Commission, I know this with respect to the project that's coming up that I'm sure you're involved in with the water supply project with Reading and North Reading. And I know that the Mass Historical Commission has expressly indicated that it is required under state law that it be consulted, and we on the Historical Commission have every reason to believe that we will be consulted as well with respect to any potential adverse impacts to that historical site with respect to that project. It's my understanding, and I could be wrong, you may want to consult with your own town council, but that same state law would govern any project that is, for which there is federal or state funding or for which there is federal or state licensing or permitting. I know that's the case with respect to the upcoming water supply project. It's also the case with respect to this project. That law governs, and I would suggest that that the town of North Reading is obligated to consult with the Mass Historical Commission with respect to any potential, mitigating any potential adverse impacts on that site. And that site, as I understand it, with respect to its being registered on the historical inventory with the state, extends out in a radius 100 feet from that bridge. So that would extend beyond, that would extend in North Reading's area, the Conservation Commission's area, in the town of Reading's area, and that is all covered under the state law with respect to these obligations. So I just wanted to express that today. Thank you.
Thank you. Virginia
Adams from the Historical Commission. Excuse me. Jonathan just threw my big statement about the 100 feet, because indeed the new construction is going to be involved within the 100 feet radius of that bridge, whether it's on the Reading side, North Reading side, or wherever. So that I think all effort must be taken to make sure that this is very sensitively done, and I'm not sure your suggestion that you will be breaking up granite and things of that nature within the 100 feet will still have an adverse impact. So let's think that one through a little bit more. Thank you.
Mike, do you have the location of the parcels that are part of Redding's property?
Like the assessors?
Yeah.
I will.
If you can give him a copy.
Yeah.
Mike, we can give you a copy later.
Okay, I'll email it to you, Mike.
Oh, do I have a copy back in my office?
Oh, yeah.
I do.
Okay.
I do.
So that you will know where you can
sure.
do your work.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for your input. Okay, next on the agenda.
Excuse me.
Oh.
So how do you intend to mitigate that 100 feet that he's proposing to be working within?
Conditions. We'll put conditions on the project.
Okay. Yeah, we will have put conditions. Now, is that through the enforcement
yep.
order? He has an enforcement order, and we'll put conditions on that stipulating where he can do his work.
So we have already issued an enforcement order, but we have to issue a modified or
just
or
we'll add some conditions to it.
Okay.
And
we would have to ratify
yeah.
that in.
So, you know, the first thing on the table as I see it is where can the work happen? Is it safer on the road right of way or somewhere else? And
if it can't be within 100 feet of the property, where?
Of the bridge.
Of the bridge.
It's a radius of 100 feet.
Of the bridge, okay.
Is there an issue using the parking area? Because that's about 140 to 70 feet away.
In the Reading area?
Yeah. It's the reason why I'm asking is because there's really nothing else on that road to pull over and park.
Unless, excuse me, unless they do their work elsewhere and bring it in.
They probably didn't bid to do that. So is there a reason not to use that area other than you know, it's just doesn't seem right, or I don't know what you're trying to get at, you know, but
it's greater than 100 feet. What's the
It's beyond 100 feet. Well, I didn't know if there's a historic reason why it can't be used.
No, for the parking lot.
So the two choices would be the road right of way, which is probably within the 100 feet, and then the parking area. And we could put, if they were going to work in the parking area, it would certainly be safer for them. And we could put conditions on the enforcement order that it's cleaned up and it's left in the same condition that it was when they arrived.
Well, first of all, is there an absolute necessity that this opposite bridge pier needs to be taken care of?
Yeah.
Yes.
Through the report from MassDOT, it's quite clear. I think they rated it, I don't know if it's level, but level 3, which means as soon as money or labor is available, it needs to be taken care of, and both those are actually in the case right now.
And what about the two piers that are on the opposite side, on the more southerly side? What is their condition?
So you're talking the side that's North Reading and the side that's Reading, the Reading side? Is my understanding there was never any work intended to be done on the Reading side.
Maybe you could provide some perspective on the work that remains to be done. So on the North Reading westerly side, where you've got to repair the abutment?
That's complete.
So you get, okay.
The abutment's done.
That's complete. The remainder of the work is just chinking.
It's just chinking?
Like just chinking.
Okay, I thought I heard you say you had to fix one of the, you don't have to move any of the big rocks.
We don't have to. There was one spot on the northwest side of the abutment in North Reading that they call for some repairs. Some of the larger blocks aren't supporting any weight of the bridge. And, you know, I would forego doing that.
I'm not asking you because I think you should not do it. I'm just trying to get an understanding. I mean, because if it's just chinking, what I'm hearing is you put a piece of plywood down and you put a rock on the piece of plywood and you hit it till you get a piece that's the right size to do the chinking. So it's not a really big body of work to do that in the parking lot.
Right.
And it doesn't sound like you've got to use a crane or a backhoe to fix the wobbly rocks on the abutment. Okay. Thank you.
And it's how many days worth of work is that, roughly?
I'm budgeted for a couple more days.
Uh-huh.
And
So, can I just, from what I heard from the representatives of the Historical Society, you know, there are two separate issues here. I don't know that we're necessarily in the position to, same way we wouldn't expect North Reading to approve something for the Reading's, you know, Conservation Commission. I don't know that we're in a position to approve certain work that's associated with the historic aspect of this site. You know, if there's additional work that has to be done and the Massachusetts Historic Commission has to be contacted, that shouldn't be up to us to say, well, if it's done in this part of the work, it's fine. I mean, whatever process they have to go through, they should go through.
But
from the wetlands aspect, if we're okay with it, I think that's fine. But I just want to make sure that the location we're deciding has nothing to do with saying this is okay from Lisa. There are other requirements that seem to need to be met besides just what we're saying needs to be met.
True, but, you know, communication and working with, you know, some of our other organizations, I don't know. I don't think it's hurting anything if they can, you know, comply with that 100 feet, and you know, it's up to you.
Is a spot available too?
Yeah, is there a spot available? It's a tight place to work.
Is that outside of the jurisdiction of the historic area? I guess that's not clear to me.
Sounds like it was. You thought that it would be.
It's not too well. it's outside 100 feet. I'll tell you that much.
We say, well, that seems reasonable. Well, the North Reading Conservation Commission said the work that they're doing seems reasonable. We don't need to talk to Reading Conservation Commission. I don't want to make that same mistake.
Yep.
You know, I just, if there's something that has to do with the historical aspect of this, then that team should be brought. You know, that team should be brought in as well. That communication needs to be had.
But they're here.
Well, that's the Reading Conservation Commission. You tell me. I don't know the right standards. So, is there another step to be taken with the state?
Well, it's my understanding, this is the issue that we're having with respect to the water project,
mm-hmm.
And I know this is the case with the water project. I am not totally certain it's the case with respect to this project, because I'm uncertain as to what licenses or permits are required here.
Right, and I wanted to mention something. I don't want to get off the track, but I don't know if this project, they would have had to file in what's called an environmental notification form with
right.
the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act. When you do that, that automatically goes to the Historic Commission. If it's a smaller project or something, and I think it was just state funds that were involved with this.
With this?
Yeah.
It's a local it's the Chapter 90 funds, but it's local road money. It's through Mass DOT, but it's at our discretion.
I'm not sure that there was that step that would have involved Mass Historical Commission. And when that happens, I don't know enough about the process. If when that happens, whether they search their database, and when that happens, I don't know if they contact the local historical commission.
Yes, and I agree, and I recognize your point is obviously well taken. We're not here necessarily because of the conservation jurisdictional issues. We're simply here to express sort of concurrent concern about a joint problem. My concern is that I'm uncertain to what degree North Reading or Reading seeks to comply with these requirements, and whether they're honored more in the breach than in the law, and I simply don't know. All I'm here to do is to express my understanding that I know that obligation exists with respect to the water project. It would be my perception that exists here. I realize I agree that you cannot impose any conditions or requirements that there be compliance with respect to Chapter 30. I'm simply here to state I would suggest that the town of North Reading seek counsel with respect to that and seek to comply if there is a need to comply. We would appreciate that.
Can I make a comment here that just might clean this up and move this along? You know, Mr. Sorrigan, you mentioned that you would be willing to use the North Reading side of the roadway right away in order to break up the chinking.
Yes.
And if he was more than 100 feet away from the bridge up in the roadway right away, up in the North Reading side to actually make that chinking and then bring it in and complete the project, I don't see really where there's a problem with that.
I don't know if there's room, but...
On the roadway.
You know, I didn't come here to
right.
like be put in an adversarial position. And if it's in the town of Reading's best interest that I stop work and enter into some type of joint venture with Reading because they're going to have to make repairs, I'll do that.
Well, I think you reached out to George Zamboris before the project started. You did your part there. I'd rather see town employees, whoever's town it is, working in a parking lot in the middle of the street on a curvy road.
I have a question. Is there a safety issue involved in completing the work that you need to complete?
No.
It is certainly more convenient right now because there's no water flow. The stream bed is dry.
I think we're all set.
All right, so I have the conditions. Some of them weren't said, so they're going to be my suggestions. So we're gonna ask that, and I'm assuming we're gonna, first off, the work would take place in the Lobs parking lot, Lobs Mill parking lot. You need to, this is probably not gonna be a lot of mess, but you need to have it back in shape when you're done. You can use that for overnight parking. I'm sure your equipment, you guys have spill kits there, so we'd like to have spill kits.
Yeah, they don't need, he's a local contractor, they don't need to park there.
Make sure there's enough room for other people to get in.
Yep.
No work in the stream bed, no removal of any more rocks from the stream bed, that's both sides. Because like I said, we're capturing you under the alter, you can't alter, you're within, you know, what you're doing over there is gonna alter our side too, so we're extending our jurisdiction. And I'm sure that between the two of us, we can get permission from the town manager to just say that it's okay that you park in the stream, in that parking lot, for whatever those days are that you mentioned. All I can think of, is there anything else?
When we saw them working there, there was a, was it a straw wattle placed on the downstream side of the river?
Mm-hmm.
Do we need that now? Or is it drying? What's your feeling about that?
You know, they're not, I don't think they're, it's a nice...
Dry, it's dry. Sort of dry.
It was a nice gesture, you know? I don't know what it was actually doing.
All right, then let's forget about it.
Yeah, I was just thinking erosion control for the, you know, the trampled down area down to the stream bed, and if that needs to be looked at afterwards. So we discussed that. So maybe you're gonna put some jute mat there, maybe not, maybe just volunteer vegetation will grow in. It didn't look bad the other day, but that's the erosion control we're talking about. Because I assume it's gonna be the same two guys in boots, and if they have to move some of those big rocks, or you discover something else, you have to work, they'll just reach over the top with their bucket truck and do the work like that.
Right.
Because we're adding conditions.
Anything else?
No. Anything else? Okay. Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion to ratify the enforcement order as with the conditions discussed.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mike. Thanks for coming.
Okay. We have a continued notice of intent and a continued enforcement order for 218 Salem Street that we reviewed the recent plan last meeting. And did you get a chance to look at the order of conditions? Or
I did not.
Chuck. What?
Is Tom here?
No.
Darren,
we need to
Darren,
announce what this one is.
Yeah.
Were you expecting him?
Yeah.
You were.
It's a continued notice of intent for 218 Salem Street, map 23, lot 90, Yonjin.
Do you want to move
ourselves? I'm sorry.
No, I mean, we're just, are we signing something on this or not?
We have something to sign.
Did we, we didn't close this, did we?
No.
Did you folks review the order of conditions?
Yeah.
I did.
You made the requested adjustments, Chuck?
I did. Yeah, what came in, I made the adjustments, and if I missed any, I can add them.
Yeah.
And I looked at it today, and I had an old one, and I had some suggestions, but he had already caught those.
Did you get O&M for
I did not.
Future invasive controls?
And I didn't get a plan to. So the plan is really for the homeowners, because they'll be monitoring that back area for invasives when they come through, and they need to know how to do it, when to do it,
right,
and how many times to do it. So that's important. And then a planting plan to show us what he's planting in that brown area right here, and the quantities and where they're going.
Okay, so this order of conditions doesn't necessarily release the enforcement order, so we can still hang on to those additional kind of laundry list items.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to approve the order of conditions?
Can I just, for my clarification really quickly, so these two things, the operational maintenance plan and the planting plan, will those be conditions of the order of conditions that they be delivered?
They are in the order of conditions that they're
that they be presented to you. And okay,
how I phrased it in the order of conditions is I have to get both copies before they can plant.
Okay.
I move we issue this order of conditions.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. So we're done with that? Or do we have to do anything else with it?
This is done.
Okay.
So we're just going to leave the enforcement order in place?
Just going to continue the enforcement
order. The enforcement order is going to be in place because they actually started some work under the enforcement order. So right now, that property is completely graded out. The retaining wall has been moved from where it was, where the new wall was, to back to the original spot. All brand new retaining wall, graded out. It's it has straw hay over everything, and they're just putting together the rest of the plan to start planting, get the fence in, and
great, good.
That's where they're at.
Okay.
All right, so we have an ANRAD 270-0666, 120 Eaton Street, and Lakeview, map 7, 18 lot 274, 75, 76, 131, 1, and 2, Federa. Oops, thank you.
Good evening. Bill Manuel from Wetlands and Land Management. I think we are all in agreement with the resource areas that we're trying to confirm with this ANRAD, and the only remaining thing was have Attorney Regnanti work with Chuck to come up with the wording that was acceptable to both parties. And it's my understanding that that's been completed, and I actually have a draft of it. I don't know if I should read it. Are you all familiar with it?
I think it got emailed.
And we
yes,
all.
I wrote it.
And if it hasn't changed since that email draft.
Were there any comments or changes?
I don't have any stringent objections to the write-up, but I will just, as a general cautious statement, I went back and I looked at the final recommended final decision by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts on the Zarachi property, which was quoted that, you know, that lawsuit that was quoted to the sort of spurned the special wording here. I'm generally speaking just uncomfortable of moving in this direction about stipulating in certain portions of town that this is not riverfront, this is canal. Because there was a lot of effort put forth as part of that Zarachi decision, a lot of arguments back and forth about when channels were straightened and what was there a river there before the channel was straightened. And there was a lot of looking into that one specific breach of Walker's Brook behind that Zarachi property. And now I think we're taking that one specific decision in regards to the main channel portion behind the Zarachi that was specific to that one decision. And we're kind of implicitly kind of applying it across town now. And you can kind of, you know, by argument, you could look at almost any channel in town and say it's a canal, except for the Ipswich River, right, which is a natural, sinuous, natural channel.
We have other rivers. We have Aberjona.
We have Aberjona, but parts of it do look like they've they're straight, and that's the not the natural course of a river necessarily. Most rivers do have some sinuosity to it. So I just want to generally caution. I just think we're in a little bit of a slippery slope here in our decision making and what we call things. And I just wanted to have that said.
And Nika, I would just point, because I went back to the recommended statement, final decision as well. I don't disagree with you. I think it is pretty clear, though, from that decision that it wasn't just that property, that this was talking about a pretty big area, of drainage and improvement. I mean, I think he pretty blatantly says in there that it's the whole thing.
Well,
riverfront, and I think we have bylaws.
Yeah,
we
have
placed our bylaws.
Well, let me just comment. He says the main channel, and he also talks about a variety of maps that were provided to him.
You know what, guys?
That I have not seen.
That would be
I would like to table this for some other time.
Yeah.
I really want us to focus on the ORAD. Did everybody read it?
Yes,
I did.
And I appreciate your comments, but. Really, this isn't the time to hash out a while ago, very convoluted and controversial and difficult.
Well, I disagree.
Okay, fine. You can disagree.
Could I ask that Mr. Manuel read that number six
Finding
into the
six.
Record so I could just review that?
Finding six. The commission confirms as accurate the bank and mean annual high water line parentheses mean MAHW, limit of BBW, inner riparian area bylaw only, 200-foot riverfront area bylaw only, and 100-foot buffer marked by Bill Manuel, Wetlands and Land Management Incorporated. The commission also confirms the limit of bordering land subject to flooding is elevation 84, parentheses, NAVD 88, close parentheses, as shown on the latest flood insurance rate map. By virtue of this delineation, the commission affirms that there is no riverfront area to Walker's Brook within the subject property under the state wetlands regulations 310 CMR 10.58, but that under section 3G, page 12 of the Redding's wetland protection regulations, such area within 200 feet of the mean annual high water line of Walker's Brook is considered riverfront area and subject to performance standards as set forth in the local regulations. This determination is made for this property only and does not constitute precedent for any other property along Walker's Brook or in the town of Reading.
That's what I have. So you all reviewed it this afternoon. There are no changes other than what I sent out. And I have a prepared ORAD in front of me for this property.
Do I hear a motion?
Comments?
Any comments? Any comments from the audience? Hearing none, do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to ratify the ORAD as stipulated. Approve the ORAD as stipulated.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? All those opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. This is a continuation of a notice of intent for 22 Pasture Road, map 44, lot 8, DeSepia. And this public hearing is now reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. And the hearing is conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents proposal. Commission will receive reports and the commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions. I'm going to introduce members of the commission, starting on my right.
David Panett.
Al Kuya. Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Indica Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn.
And Chuck Cerrone, Conservation Administrator.
Good evening, I'm Stephen Erickson from North Environmental Service. The commission has seen this before. The proposal is for the construction of an addition to an existing single-family home. At the last hearing, the commission asked for some mitigation and additional infiltration of the driveway. So what we've done is we've put a trench drain across the back of the driveway to put a 2-foot slope from the beginning of the driveway to the end of the driveway. So there's plenty of slope. We're going to infiltrate that into a chamber out in the back. There's also an existing trench drain in front of the garage. We're going to infiltrate that part as well. Then we've called for plantings of shrubs, a variety of shrubs, along the property line as additional mitigation.
And you submitted a variance, one-page
yes.
variance?
We did.
Request that we got this afternoon?
We got it this afternoon, and then they updated it because I asked that they put on at least 10 native plants that they would be planting, which they did. But that's up to the commission if you think more is needed in this situation. But I needed to have at least something on it.
A couple of questions. You said the existing trench drain is in front of the garage doors, right?
Yes.
And is there another one? Did you say there's a second one?
The existing trench is in front of the garage door.
Yeah.
We're proposing another trench across the
okay.
back.
Okay. Right.
I don't know where that existing trench goes. I assume that it goes into the ground.
Yeah.
But we didn't dig it up to find
okay.
out. So we're just going to tie it into ours so it goes into the infiltration area.
Okay.
It'll go into a gas and oil separator and then into the
okay.
infiltration area.
And I didn't understand the 12 feet, the reference to 12 feet in the variance.
It's
that's
right.
the difference between the existing driveway
yeah.
and the
area.
Lawn area to the wetland hydric soil pasture next to it, which was right here.
So
you look
the
at the screen.
The wetland boundary over here was previously determined by this commission.
Yeah.
And of course we can't maintain that because I don't think it ever had
yeah.
an existing 12-foot separation.
Why 12 feet?
That's the distance
that's
between.
That's what your regulation calls for.
Okay.
No, no, it's
no,
what?
Our regulation
it's
calls for 35
feet
for
no
structures, but you're just 12 feet away
from the hydric soil.
From the existing, I guess, wetland edge. I don't know where does the phrase 12 feet come up? I don't.
It does,
isn't that
it's
the
not.
Distance?
That was in the variance request, wasn't it?
It's not in our regs. I don't know where
don't
it
know.
Came up.
Do you have the variance that we can pull up?
Sometimes.
Steve, is that the distance between the driveway and the hydric soil over here? Is that what the 12 feet is?
Let me get my scale out.
That's the only thing I can think of.
It
I
is
know.
12 feet. Well, it says the existing driveway is already within 12 feet and cannot be easily relocated. So there's the distance
that's
that
the,
everyone's talking
that's the
about.
Distance.
But
and
not then according
to the regulation request a variance to the 12-foot wetland setback. So that was.
So
that
you said variance
doesn't work.
You said
yeah.
variance to the 12-foot
yeah.
wetland setback requirement.
Yeah, that's
which there isn't.
Is.
There isn't one.
Yes.
So
we're 6
so
feet
a,
away.
So you're saying a variance to the 35-foot no structure? Is that what we really need to approve?
Is it drive
or 25-foot no disturb?
It's about.
Scale, so.
The new one or the old one?
I'm not questioning the like where it's
yeah.
going and
yeah,
where
so
it is today. 35
foot.
No structure.
No structure. That's what he's requesting a variance
okay.
from.
Okay.
So we just rephrase this and get another copy tomorrow.
All right.
So
you see what I was talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, my hearing's better this.
Oh. All right.
So in your native plantings, would they be along Where would they be? Where are you proposing to place those?
We just called from along the property line.
Okay.
I didn't think it was really important where they are. I kind of like the builder or homeowners to decide where they would like those plants for aesthetic reasons. The advantage is that all of the plants that we chose have some kind of very wildlife food and nesting areas for potential birds, and it makes kind of a buffer between the other property.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like a permanent boundary along the property line.
That sounds good. Yeah.
Sounds good to me.
I don't usually remember seeing an oil grit separator.
That's new.
On a residential property. Is that recommendable?
It's great.
It's great.
Yeah.
Does it,
require?
It's completely better.
Yeah, I was going to say. I mean, is it going to require?
Anytime you go into a parking lot,
right?
Yeah.
You see oil where the cars were parked.
Yeah.
Infiltration of that material without some kind of cleaning doesn't make any sense. For one of the reasons I don't like pervious pavement, because oils break down with ultraviolet light and oxygen. So infiltrating that stuff into the ground isn't a real smart idea to me. I think the state disagrees with me, but.
So you're going to take it, put it in an infiltration system that can treat it before.
No, it's not a big unit or anything.
Yeah.
It doesn't have
no,
any water block.
So that's, there's an O&M for that too.
Yes.
An O&M plan.
And did we get that?
Yeah.
Is that part of what you submitted today with?
No,
I didn't see it.
Okay.
I'll work on that.
What's
okay.
involved in?
But the
even
town
just
engineer requires
charts.
Clean it out once a year.
Yeah. Do you want to just go with what Ryan put on his? So Ryan reviewed this drainage
right,
calculations,
yeah.
and he
right.
put down some requirements, which would probably cover what the operation and maintenance plan would be.
Okay.
So.
I just
So I mean, we could put that. Yeah. So we could put that in the conditions that we just follow what town engineering.
Yeah.
Recommended for maintenance.
Did he include the oil-water separator, though? Because that's in the condition.
He reviewed it, yeah.
He reviewed it.
He reviewed this.
Yes.
Because it's dated today.
He reviewed.
I'm going to say yes,
yes
just
okay.
one more time.
Okay.
And,
okay. All right. I believe you.
Do you want to read his?
Yeah, I guess so.
Would you like to read what he put
down? I'll
take
down? A quick peek, sure.
In the no structure zone.
Right.
The driveway.
So drop paved asphalt driveways and permanent construction in 35.
Yes. Okay. It just generally speaks about inspecting the system.
Original,
yeah.
And so
we always have.
We'll just say
the reason
oil water separator
so
is part of it.
Odd is because
it's yeah.
the pasture that's next
I
to
just,
it.
I'm
right.
not sure.
We usually
been identified
require
as
a lot more than this, but it's a parking lot, not in someone's
yeah.
driveway
yeah.
to the other.
Right.
Because there's a drainage
so we'll
canal right there that's off
the
side of the driveway.
Conditions.
I understand that.
So
I understand.
I could see a resident not checking it, not
so
checking that,
still,
not checking it, and then
the
coming up with.
We're going to say we're cleaning
the variance
for
that
the driveway in the 35-foot story.
Yes, and that the planting of the native shrubs, which provide habitat and
okay.
also forage.
Can I just got lost in between
the
conversations. I heard something about the variance. Can you
sure.
catch us up
because
with what's
yes,
going
they're
on?
Asking why should we allow the variance?
Can you just one conversation, guys?
First of all, the first one was, when did we say that a driveway was a structure within 35 no structure? I mean, we don't allow structure, which is that's
and driveways a structure. The only thing we've allowed closer is the riprap so far. Okay. So the riprap from Mariano Drive, that was the only thing that's been closer so far in the 35-foot zone.
Well, I mean,
And
he gets the variance, fine, but someone else could argue that.
And then he said, why the variance? And I said, well, you know, the planting of the native shrubs is providing habitat, you know, better food source and some kind of shelter for some birds, maybe.
So there were three reasons
in
the variance request, right? Just like we typically ask for. So those would be the reasons. You know, I would argue that the wetlands that we're getting closer to is not one that we necessarily value in this, that we would, you know, what we're adding here has a lot more value than what.
And as David pointed out, that there is a berm in between.
Yep.
So in a drainage ditch.
Yeah.
Yep. And we understand that, but.
So I think considering that this is a special case where allowing something this close is well suited.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, the variance, I can't add any more to what Mike said. I think they're offering a lot for a very practical need that is pretty much in tune to the house that they're building.
So we need a motion. Are we going to incorporate, Anika, we're going to incorporate what Ryan said and accept that as an O&M plan?
I maybe add to an inspection or two or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll send you something tomorrow, and if you agree, we'll just send it out. Okay.
Are we continuing
this?
All right. So do I hear a motion to?
Make a motion to accept the issue an order of conditions for 22 Pastor Road. And the variance.
Can we combine them together?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Of course, I forgot to ask the public, do you have any comments?
We already voted.
Yeah. Okay, hearing none, which is a good thing. We'll move on.
Yeah, let me send this out before.
What? Well, no.
Give me 1 second to catch up.
Come on, you guys.
Thanks. We need like a checklist.
Yeah, work on your notes.
They used to have them. They gave one to Anika, but I don't have it.
No, I didn't have a checklist. I had the script. I never had a.
I've got
a script. I tried to come up with a checklist, but.
285 Main Street, Prefectos minor plan change.
We're here to ask for permission to.
Could you introduce yourself, please?
Andrew Moreno.
Okay.
And this is Matt Gabriel.
Thanks, Gabriel.
Okay, thank you.
I don't have any pictures.
To three branches that are hanging over the building to be pruned off. That's it. And we want to put some. We had some banking erosion, so we want to put some coral logs at the bottom and stiffen up the bank. That's it.
So a question about this project.
Can we set it up first?
Okay.
I went to a site visit because the owner, Max Gabriello, wanted to. He's getting ready to be finished his project, and he wanted to make sure that he understood the, and I understood what he was going to do for the vegetation plan. So there was an established order of condition that laid out where planting is going to be done on the left and the right, and in behind this building. And maybe the bank in back of the building was a little more established and a little bit wider when the order of conditions went in, but this building foundation hasn't moved in the back. The foundation that's there is the original tuxedo building, which they had to add on to. So when we went out there, we discussed there's like four spots, left, right, and there's one close to the building by the parking area, and there's one directly in back. The planting area directly in back of the building is the only one that they feel like that can't be maintained, and that the wash from coming down that stream, which is Walker's Brook, has eroded the bank so much. It's so close to the building that they threw some stone on it just to try to keep it in place and to try to set up that area as a, you know, no non-planting area. The other three spots, they're gonna plant exactly as the plan calls out for. So during that site visit, Andy mentioned to me, which was has been obvious to me for a long time, that there's these trees that are growing right out of the foundation, and they're going straight up along the side of the building, and they're at the top now, and they're branching out. And Andy wants to cut them, not down, but he wants to cap them. And anything that's not growing over the building and is heading in the opposite direction, he'll leave that leader in place. So he's just gonna surgically remove the tops of the building. Anything that's not growing over this stays. So there's three or four or five trees, something like that. He's gonna take care of what he needs to take care of.
Light pruning.
But that's kind of a situation where you would, if you went out there and saw it, I think maybe some of us did, I couldn't imagine not giving permission to take the trees down at some point, because it's just, they're in the wrong spot. And it's just so obvious. So in light of not doing the planting in back and pruning the trees, he said that he will help himself out and help the commission too by stabilizing that bank. So fortunate that Andy has a person, he's in the construction field, he has a person that has worked with core logs before, and he got all the information on them. And what he's going to do is he's going to tie in two rows of core log where it's needed along the back of that building to stop the undermining and erosion of the bank. So he's here to ask you for those things, to allow the core logs, to allow the riprap in back of the building instead of the planting, and to top the trees as I explained it.
So we went out, Al and Dave and I went on Sunday morning. Are there going to be gutters on the building?
Yes.
Okay. All right. And the core logs are going to be in the stream?
Yes. At the base of the stream.
In the bank, really.
What happened was when they did the sewer and the water on Main Street, they had all these pumps going in into the river, and they were just washing the riverbank right out. I mean, it was unbelievable. So there was nothing I could do. I mean, that's the state. But what happened was also there's a problem on the other side of the parking lot. When they plow, they keep dumping material over their shoulders, and it's just washing down this side. So it's kind of pushing everything towards the
Oh, on the other side of the stream.
Yeah, the other side of the stream. They're actually plowing, and all the sand and debris is going up over the... I mean, that would be great if you could prevent them from keep doing that, because it's kind of closing off the riverbank.
You're saying from the apartments?
Yeah, the apartments. Mm-hmm. It's kind of pushing the water towards the building. But there's nothing I can do about that. I mean, that's not under me.
So, I don't want to talk badly about our neighbors, but
exactly.
Basically at the bottom of our
we're trying to stabilize it.
We want to stabilize what's happening to the bank that runs up to the building. We want to put some core logs there to make everything more stable.
Yeah.
So what's the diameter of these core logs?
You
get 12
inch. All different sizes. 10 inch, 12 inch, 8 inch.
Because I mean, I got down in the stream, and I mean, you're from the water. It's carved out. It's undermined.
Exactly.
That's where we want to put the.
So you're going to be, but you're going to be in the water pushing those in.
Well, it was dry yesterday. The day
I know,
before.
But it's,
it just happened to get. We got a little rain and it just went up a little bit. But that thing's been dry all year.
I know, and I was standing and I just. You're in the stream bed. You're not.
Exactly.
So and I don't necessarily disagree with what you're doing. Just you're literally putting them in the stream, and I
you're in the stream, but you're at the bottom of the bank.
Yeah,
I've used them on another project.
Before.
No, I understand.
That was soil.
Yeah.
And
before they did those sewer and water.
And we also had, we were out there Tuesday night, and we were talking about a double. And there's a one place where there's about this much undermining, so we were talking maybe two. So you'd stack them one, two, like that.
All right.
And the vegetation they put vegetation in it, and then, you know, the roots go into the bank and stabilize it. That's the whole.
Just kind of continue on what you're saying, though. You know, I did see where it would go. I think there's a good spot for it where the bank is clearly eroding. But considering the work that is being done, what I would like to see when these are actually installed, I would just want to make sure Chuck is notified that, look, it's happening today. Chuck, I ask you to, you know, you don't have to be out there the whole time, but to get out there and just see, make sure it's going in the spot that we all think it's going into. Because it is work in a moving area. But otherwise, I don't really have any other issues with what's being proposed.
So as I was looking at, the other thing I thought of is where, and maybe this is what you're talking about, where you're not going to be able to maintain the plants. Is that the pines and the junipers that are dead?
The pines, those were just temporary plantings, so nothing would wash down while the work was being done. I just planted those above the hay bales, because the hay bales were set low, and the grades were off once they raised that 1 foot for the slab. So it was like I had to put something so nothing would go down. I was trying to impact the river as least as possible. Yeah. I wanted nothing to fall into that river.
So, you know, as I was looking at that and I was looking at the trees, it's so shady in there that I almost feel like cutting more down is better so that things get some light and can grow a little bit. I mean, it's not an area where I've got a lot of expertise, but if you want things to, you know, plugs in the core logs to actually sprout and get a little bit of light, or at least you got to be really careful about the plants you pick that are going to spread and stabilize that bank.
It's a tough area. I mean, that's all the privacy shading either place has. And just to back up for a second,
I'm not saying
where
cut
those
it. I get that.
Dead
I just
junipers are. That's an area that's going to get replanted. We're only talking about the very back of the building where the stone is.
Right.
That's
and
all.
Don't forget those trees are going to be topped. That have the canopy over the
roof. But it's like it's right behind the building, and then you got the trees up above, and then if you put the pines on the side where those junipers died, it's just really, really shady back there. It's going to be hard to get anything to grow, and my worry would be anything you plant washes out before it gets established. So the only thing I'm saying is let's just pick something that something like poison ivy that grows really well. It's hard to get rid of.
There's plenty
of
that right
now. You know what I mean?
It's a bittersweet while you're
Yeah, no, but I mean something that's going to take quickly and spread on the ground.
A minute vine, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Cut two
plant? Yeah, 1 foot an hour.
So anyway, thank you.
Thanks.
Do what?
I'd like to
Al?
Clear it all out too, but we don't want me to do that.
No,
Al, do you have
I
a question?
I think the plan was done by a landscape architect,
exactly.
So I think we're going to stick with the
plan. Al has a question.
I was out there on the site walk, and we walked around the corner of the building. It looked to me like, and this is pretty much out of character for me, but it looked to me like that building and that site needed a lot more than this piece of paper. I think I'd like to see a better plan submitted to us on exactly how you're going to stabilize that, when it's going to be installed, what's going to be planted, how it's going to be done.
Well,
that corner is it. I mean, you said you didn't want to even go in that river. That silt fence was 5 years old, and it looked like it'd been in the water for 5 years. There hasn't been an attempt for a long
in
time to try and. The silt fence was down into the bank of the water at the corner of the building.
That hasn't been up for 5 years. We put.
It looked it.
Well. You know, I'm just letting you know, we put that up right before we started construction.
The idea is to put it in, and you're supposed to maintain it. So it's supposed to be maintained at all times, and that hasn't been maintained in a long time.
Yeah. We're trying to less
whole
impact
bank is,
that river
I mean,
bank as possible.
Yeah, 10 or 20 feet on both sides of the corner of that wall, that bank is horrendous. I don't know how you're going to stabilize that. So even if you put these logs in, I don't know, you haven't said anything about the length of these? I mean, are they 20, 30 feet from each corner? How long are they? Because that bank is bad on both
sides
of the corner of
that
building.
I just want you to know that we had submitted a plan way back that was already approved. This is in addition to only because of what's happened since
from,
the state.
Yeah, first they did the sewer water. That's the only reason we're asking
we've
for
yeah,
no, I listen, I get it. Things happen to you, and the plan's changed, and it's been a while, and that's okay. But
Well, we didn't cause the impact.
I know. I understand that. But
and the other thing.
The hoses are still in the river from the state job. They just left them
there. We basically were approved for a plan that we have submitted.
Yeah, we're trying to fix what's going on.
And now we're trying to just make it a little bit better by doing that.
You have to fix what's going on.
Well, we're trying.
Conditions, you have to, so it's not a voluntary thing, but I'm just saying that I don't know how much, I'm only one person in this board, but I think we need more than this. I would like to see a more comprehensive approach to repairing that bank.
Well, the right way to repair it would be clean the other side of the river and open it up so the water's funneling that way straight, instead of this guy dumping material onto this riverbank and diverting the water towards us. And then when they did the sewer and water, they're shooting all this water down and just carved out a hole into our bankage.
Well, if
that's what happened,
whatever your plan is, if you think that's your best plan of attack,
it's not my river.
I would like to see that.
We don't own the other side of the river though. That's the problem. I'm just trying to stop our side from eroding any more than it is.
Yep, I know. I get it.
I just have a question about I know when they're installed what core logs, you know, effectively do, but over time that's going to degrade, right? I mean, over time,
if
those break down.
If we don't do anything, it's going to degrade even more than it is.
No, I mean the log itself. It's going to eventually disintegrate.
But what?
You know, and rot,
but the whole design of it is they put vegetation in it.
And it composts.
Right. And it, that provides a substrate, but the vegetation is supposed to, you know, start to get into the bank.
Oh, okay.
That vegetation is going to be on a mic. What is that? 5:1? What is that slope at the corner of that building? I mean, it's almost vertical.
Yeah, but the vegetation comes out of the core log.
Right.
It gets built out of the core log.
Yeah,
so
the core log
is stable.
To
be, they can be stacked 2 or 3
right
high.
Yeah.
It's not very uncommon to see that.
Well, I think
they use this on bank stabilization pretty regularly. It's
good.
Pretty effective.
You could ask that they... You were checking in to see if they came seeded already. Did you find that out?
Yeah, they did.
You could just get core logs that have seeds in them, or you could stake them with willow.
Right.
I mean, one of the
that's
other.
That's typically what they. Yeah.
I don't have a problem with this proposed plan. It's a minor plan change request, and that core log does one of two things that it needs to do. It begins to be a source of revegetation of that slope. And it also acts as an erosion stopper.
Did you guys go see it? Any of you guys?
Yes.
Anika, have you seen
okay.
it?
I've seen all the pictures.
Okay.
And I've seen it in the past, but I haven't seen the most recent erosions.
Okay.
Because
I know it's a difficult
well,
spot
we got,
because
we got this for a drawing, but what it really is this, and this is the core log.
Right,
mm-hmm.
Right,
and there might be
right.
another one on top of it too.
And the sun is over here.
Right.
I don't think anything's going to grow in this, and it's going to wash away. That's
well,
what I
if
think.
If it doesn't, no. then it's their money poorly spent.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but we're just
and
we
don't. But
this
is just a minor plan change, and you know they're not asking for their final certificate of compliance. You know, so they're proposing a solution, and if they want to. Take their chance at this and move forward.
So the town does have a easement over that stream. So, you know, ultimately, it could be the town's issue. But even that undercutting there can be managed. You would just hold the core log out a bit, and you could just backfill, and that's kind of how that situation would happen. So you just want to establish the bank. We're not going to. I mean, I know you said like pack it in there, but that's not really what's going to happen. We're going to establish the bank. We're going to go to the leading edge, and we're going to stake them in at that point. If we have to do a little bit of backfill, we will. We'll either get the seeded ones or the staked, the willow stakes, and do that. And you know, this actually is not part of their order of conditions. This is what they said they would do because. You saw how close it was to that one corner of their foundation. Something has to happen, and they just want to get on top of this situation. And they're saying, look, we are not doing one of the plantings, so we'll do a little horse trading here. So that's really where we're at. I mean, he can get his certificate of compliance. just by planting that area in the back? Are you guys approving, you approving the riprap, but he doesn't have to fix the stream. He only has to plant those four areas.
You would give us a...
The town has...
He has a complete order of conditions. What's that?
Now,
this board would vote for a certificate of compliance on that order of conditions.
That has nothing
with
to do
that
with...
stream, the way it looks
nothing
today?
To do
there is no
it has nothing to do with his project. That's town easement.
That's not
on his property?
No.
Well, I don't know if it's not, but it's the town that has an easement over it. And the original order of conditions didn't say repair the bank.
Right.
So he's not in here to...
It probably didn't need repair at the time. It's eroded since.
Not from me.
Yeah.
Not from our work. From the state's work.
Okay, listen. I can't believe I'm arguing this point, but that's fine.
I just can't actually.
That's fine.
I'm not explaining it clearly. I mean,
whatever.
I think that's what's happening. It's not his work to do. I mean, if he was doing this project in the first place and he needed some mitigation, this is a perfect spot. We would say, hey, fix that stream bank because look what it looks like. But back, I don't know, 2006, is that when you got this permit?
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't the case out there. I don't know.
Any comments from the public?
Hearing none. I move we issue a minor plan change as discussed tonight.
I'll second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for your service.
Thank you.
Okay.
Did everyone, was that a unanimous?
No, it's not. Yeah.
That is not going to end well.
Are these in my... I was going to bet on it.
This is a public hearing for 270-0669, Lot 4, Kylie Drive, Map 34, Lot 143, Dahadwala. Is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents proposal. Commission will receive reports from the administrator, advisors, and other town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and then the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. There is a sign-in sheet, and I would encourage anybody to sign that if they just came in. I'd like to introduce the members of the commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Lee Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
David Pinnett.
Okay.
I got that. Okay. Do you want me to go down and get this plan so I can put it on the board?
Yeah, would you mind?
Yeah, we're gonna need that.
He's going to get the plan and put it up on the smart board.
That's not a problem.
Just take me a minute.
The applicant just wanted to introduce himself.
Oh, absolutely.
We owe $125. He has a check in his car. Hold on, I didn't grab that.
Oh, great.
Okay.
Hello, everybody. I'm Mustali Dohadwala. I'm the owner of the property and looking to develop it. No questions. Feel free to ask. Thanks. Thank you.
Did you go out here Tuesday?
Yes.
We did.
Yes.
And we met with members of the Trails Committee and a woman from the Open Reading Open Land Trust as well.
I look forward to your report.
Yeah, okay. Actually, we saw all the sites. Yep, we got to them all.
Did any of you guys read my notes?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Did you read it?
Would you want us to laugh over email?
I give you gentlemen incredible props for cleaning up.
We did that for you mostly. We needed
that. warmed my heart.
The homeless person, I think it was kids.
Yeah. I could hear you screaming.
I got to one point and I said, that's it, I'm not going further. Because I went in and went to the left on the blue trail.
Right.
Got to some stuff, and then I saw them.
He took all that stuff out of it.
Dad's in his garage saying, where'd those kids put the tent, sleeping bag, and camp stove?
Someone was looking to tailgate down in Foxborough and say, where's my stove?
And one of those kids is slacking because I found about 3 full beers back then.
Did you?
He was faking.
Faking, yeah.
Nice, I had hard tea.
Yeah, there's
hard
some
tea.
Hard liquor down there,
hard
too.
Hard tea.
It's hard. They were probably 21, it's okay.
Yeah.
Never okay to litter.
Never okay to litter. I don't want to see that crying Indian anymore. So besides that one area down there, it actually wasn't that bad. I think we hit most of the debris that was down there. That stuff you saw, we just went around the corner to the right. There was a little bridge and some cans there we grabbed.
Yeah.
They actually left us the plastic bags to clean up, right?
Yeah,
filled their bags.
They left plastic bags, but they didn't fill them?
Yeah.
They had every good intention, though.
The plastic bags were emergency raincoats.
Yeah, that's what they were.
Or sleeping bags.
We should have known not to let Chuck go.
I think maybe it's close to time we built some campsites in our town for us so
yeah.
that we could charge a fee and get
some revenue.
Some revenue for that.
Aren't there spots already?
Town Forest has
the
circle.
The Forest Committee supposedly
There's
has authority to create and charge
well,
already.
There is camping
for,
in there
for
scouts
yeah.
occasionally.
At the council ring?
At the council ring.
Yeah.
The town forest.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
That's
big, we want campfires on the trail of Pinedale.
No.
Do we? A couple of those neighbors don't, I know that.
Oh, no.
That's a trail.
No.
This is the trail easement.
Oh, wait.
That's a drain easement. This one here.
That's this trail easement.
Trail.
This must be this here.
It doesn't follow us. It's kind of strange. It kind of follows it a little bit here and then it goes off.
Okay, so I think here.
The trail.
No, here is the dream.
Yeah. I
here is the trail.
I didn't know.
You think so?
Yes.
Unless it's a big
what we're filing for is a single family house located within the 100-foot buffer zone. Maintain the structure outside of the 35-foot no build zone and all disturbances out of the ready 25-foot no disturb zone. This is an existing subdivision. I think the last home was completed in 2009 or 2010, and the order of conditions closed out on that project. So this would be a new order for this last house in this subdivision. It's existing vacant lot. What we're looking to do, like I said, single-family house, about 2,500 square feet of roof space. That includes covered porches and other overhangs. A pool would be to the west of the house. Associated walkways and landscaping. It's been designed to work within your setbacks. Water and sewer services are to the curb line. We bring those. We are going to be moving the driveway curb cut from what's existing to the easterly side of the lot. We did receive some comments from the Trails Commission. We will stay outside of the easement with all the structures. We do some regrading in the easement at the garage. We maintain a slope no steeper than 3-to-1, most areas 4-to-1. And then we do some regrading again at the lower portion where we go to a 4-to-1 slope from an existing 3-to-1 to kind of trade off the 3-to-1 area that was located down here. Here. Again, the trail that's set there would be maintained as a trail and remain in the easement at the completion of the work. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions or concerns.
Yeah, I have some questions. That we went to the site on Tuesday, and from the curb cut or the curb, it seems to go down very, very steeply. Are you putting in fill at the structures and the pool? And
there is some fill going in. The house will actually, the large kind of depression.
Yeah, yes.
You can see these contours where they come back. The house will fill that area. So the garage floor is walking out very close to existing grade. Currently you're at 198.7 here. So you'll be walking out, you know, at about 198.3 at the back of the basement wall. So the fill area will actually be basement for this portion of the house. There is a little bit of, I don't want to really call it fill. We're coming up a foot with the patio, but again, you're going to have a pool in this low area here, which is about 3 feet lower. So you're going from 206 down to 202. So that, again, that works with the topography of the lot. There's a lot of planning that went into the layout of this lot to make everything work. And I think the landscape architects did a great job fitting the structures into the top.
The garage is a very odd shape. Is this a two-car garage?
It is a three-car garage.
Okay.
So you would have one vehicle parked in this door here, and then you would be able to park two vehicles tandem on that. Right.
So did it have full foundation under the entire structure?
Foundation is from this line over, so this would be full basement, and then it would be slab on grade for the garage. So
you just mentioned that you were walking out the back of the
this section of the structure here.
You had said you walk out the back of the garage on grade.
I'm sorry, the basement from this section of the structure.
Okay.
This is slab on grade, but it would be a full foundation.
Okay.
At the rear.
Also, I know that that there is a kind of a bump out on the driveway that looks like there's asphalt in the easement of the path. And we did look at the language in the easement, and the easement gives the authority to Conservation Commission. So can you move that?
That was put there to allow a car to be able to back out and turn around. Instead of backing directly out into the street, it is a cul-de-sac, so we could back out. The trail easement itself doesn't exclude pavement, and if you went to the other end of this trail, it actually comes out to someone's driveway on Charles Street. So you actually have to walk over someone else's driveway at the other end of this trail. So we felt that was kind of consistent.
At the other end of this trail?
Yes.
Where?
Charles Street.
It goes through to Charles Street, the green.
So if you walk that trail straight through, you would come out on Charles Street.
It's next to the cemetery. There's like a wall.
Ah, I see.
And then a driveway, and it's a little odd there, but you're really kind of walking between the wall and someone's driveway. But it's odd.
And you know, when we did read the letter that was put together by the Trails Committee, and if I were walking back there, I would feel kind of odd going through somebody's backyard and especially over a driveway.
It is placed over a buildable lot. I mean, the thought must have been that there would be a house built on this lot.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. Yes.
We did try and coordinate the garages on the side, so any windows would fairly be decorative. It's not like you're walking by living space. We don't have any issue with putting a trailhead sign, you know, up by the street.
There already is a trailhead sign.
Yeah, we're maintaining that sign to indicate the trail is there. If the major concern is that little bump out.
What's the definition of an impediment? Because to me, if I'm walking down a trail and, you know, I like my privacy, I'm sure everyone likes their privacy, and instead of being in the garage, there's a car kind of in that turnaround area, and I'm feeling uncomfortable about getting into someone's private space. So I'm asking you, you know, and that would impede my access to that path, and I'm wondering how you can solve that feeling that I'm going to have, and I think that maybe other trail walkers might have.
Might that be a safety issue with somebody backing out, with somebody walking down the trail?
People walk on the sidewalk, you back on the sidewalk. You know, you're more apt to see traffic on the sidewalk than you are on the trail.
You know, I read the memo by the Trails Committee, and I appreciated their input. And I have to say, I strongly agreed with all of their points. Just overall, looking at the project, you're correct, you know, technically in saying that you have stayed out of the setbacks, but the overall design is one of really maxing out the size of the house to take up almost every square foot of space that is not some limit somebody has put. And in the case of the trails, you're not even paying attention to that. You're really infringing into the trails easement. And I think there's a way to build a sellable house in Reading that doesn't have such a large footprint.
It's
and
being built to be an inhabitable house for the owner and his family. And this is what they want. The actual language in the recorded deed is set easements for the following purposes: creating, marking, and maintaining a trail for public use of sufficient width to pass and repass by foot only. Now, a sidewalk is 4 feet wide. So the trail would only need to be 4 feet wide within the easement. No bicycles or motorized vehicles shall be permitted. The grantor, successors, heirs, and assigns shall not relocate any part of said easement without the permission. The trail just needs to exist within the easement.
Do you think the trail exists within? What would the trail look like traversing that driveway?
It would stay outside. It would go 4 feet and then down along the slope and meander within the 10-foot easement.
So how wide is the existing trail easement?
The easement's 10 feet. However, the rights are only for passage on foot.
Amen.
And a reasonable person would look at it.
And what measures are there any proposed plantings? Are there any proposed privacy guards?
The easement doesn't mention privacy. It just mentions the ability
to.
Well, I understand that, but you're the designing engineer.
Yeah, I mean.
You're coming before us, you know, and we're looking at a trail situation.
The purview of the Conservation Commission is for conservation purposes within the buffer zone. I mean, we're talking about an area.
And it's for the management.
So the
management of the easement.
So what's the, Chuck, do you have the wording for that, that easement?
If we wanted to relocate the easement, the Conservation Commission has the right to comment. The work within.
Under the care, custody, and control.
Yeah, the grantor, successors, heirs, and assigns shall not relocate any part of said easement without the permission of the Reading Conservation Commission?
The easement is not moving. The only thing is the trail. And the trail just has to be within the easement. And the area that we're doing any work, as far as the driveway, is outside the 100-foot buffer zone, which is the limit of the jurisdiction at the board.
So how is the construction going to happen to respect the 35-foot setback? And there's fill within 35 feet, between 35 and 25 feet.
That's,
so
35-foot is a no structure zone.
Right.
The 25-foot is a no work zone. All work would be upgrading to 25-foot. There's a silt fence line.
Right.
There's only earth and grading within
right.
25 to 35.
Right. The intent of the additional 10 feet past the 25 is to protect the root zone established in that 25 foot. I mean, does this resident really understand that, you know, out that backyard, it's there's like no grass between the back side of the house and the wetland line, that it's vegetation?
Yes, there's about 10 feet of
10 feet.
10 to 12 feet from the closest point here. That would be lawn, or I haven't looked thoroughly at the landscape plan back there, but or some form of landscaping. There's really no entrances other than basement entrance and access going up there. The bulk of the work, they've spent a lot of time focusing on this area, and this is the area that they're looking to use. They also own houses next door, so they're, you know, looking to kind of make this a central point between the two houses.
Is the plan complete in terms of illustrating entrances, little stairways, pads at the base of decks, all of that sort of thing? So there's nothing outside of that footprint.
And the goal is to build the foundation and the retaining wall first. So they would do this kind of grading. And then you construct this retaining wall that works under the deck here, that would support part of the deck, the foundation wall, the footings for this porch, and then work their way back out of the site.
The porches are going to have a full foundation?
I don't believe so. The pool equipment is stored underneath it, so it's going to be a deck, a covered deck and porch with an open area, like a three-season home.
Can you help me understand the dark gray? Is it a retaining wall between the pool and the 35-foot line?
So the dark?
Almost like a
zigzag line.
Yeah, the zigzag, the very dark gray
this
between
right here?
The pool.
It's removing the existing wall.
When you go out there, there's an existing riprap stone wall.
Oh,
yeah.
That's removing
so
that,
we're gonna,
replace
we're
it with the
that.
Proposed retaining wall.
Yep.
Okay.
Put an existing retaining wall.
Okay, gotcha.
Across.
I don't understand that.
What's the tree that's being removed at the house? It was a huge multi-trunk. Do you know what that was?
One that's down the bank?
Large crab.
A crab apple.
Yeah.
One that's down the bank or the one that's up close to the street? One that's down the bank is a crab apple.
It's huge, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
So can you explain again the nature of the plantings that are going to happen between the proposed house and the wetland flags?
I would suggest that we mostly use natives throughout that area. The intent is not to have a manicured lawn between the house and the resource. Only only mowed access along the trail down the side, and then just native plant material. We haven't got to the point where we've designed the planting, but that's the intent.
Okay. So are you talking herbaceous, shrub, tree,
yes.
variety?
Yep, a good variety, yeah.
Okay. What else was I going to ask? I saw
I
from the...
I would encourage you to in that area, at least at the 25 foot into the wetland, to use native plants
mm-hmm.
rather than any ornamentals.
Mm-hmm. I noticed from the field site visit notes that there was a question about flags 9 through 12, or at least Harry.
Yeah, so
you
I wrote that in part because I knew you guys would probably go. And we looked at it quickly. And
let me ask, were those flags part of an original ANRAD?
Yes, they were the original flags, and then our botanist was involved when we walked that.
Well, that's not what I read.
The flags, are there, some aren't, some are different
right.
labels. They're
some new flags?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, 9 to 12, as I read it, were placed based on the survey.
Yes, we recreated the flags.
You recreated the flags.
But then you put some other flags up, but they're not. We found there was no 11. There was an 11A, which was kind of up. And then there were a couple.
13 and 13A. So
yeah.
I think 13 may have been the actual 13A, and maybe there was a
there was a 13
in
next
else.
To a tree and not tied.
The summary report says the flags were replaced and reevaluated by Ms. Hayes. Does she have any field data forms?
No.
Are these?
Not
just
this.
Asking.
No, I believe she just walked the line.
She just walked the line.
Yeah, Elizabeth Wallace from our office.
Yeah, okay. All right.
The reason I pointed that out is there is, the placement of the house depends on where the flags are. I mean, there isn't an inch to spare. And if you're a couple feet off, and we didn't have an auger to inspect the soils or do anything more than just eyeball it at the time. You know, if we said this is off by 3 feet, it's a big problem for this house. So I think that it's important that we get the flags right early. So that's why I mentioned that. I thought that from, I think, was 13 the one on the big tree?
Yes.
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 13 up looked fine. 12 and below looked like they could be open to interpretation. So, yeah.
Those
yeah.
That's in one of the areas that we're furthest away with the house, but yes, I mean we can.
Right, but you're right next. Your 35 foot is right next to a structure.
To get the corner of
the 35 foot line.
13.
That flag 13. That's
but even
6/10 of a foot off.
And then
11 and 10A, you're right.
But even yeah. going over by the deck.
Okay, yeah, 11 and 10A and 11, if those move it at all.
I don't mind having them go out do a couple soil cross sections of
jump. So she should either go with me or the commission?
Yep.
So
yeah.
We'll have to just schedule
which
the time.
Whichever the commission prefers.
So, Nika, I kind of interrupted you on the flags. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. That's all I wanted to say about that.
Is there any wiggle room? I feel that this, I know that the impervious surface is fine with the 35,960 square feet of the lot, but it just seems like it's so maxed out. And I still have some issues with the trail easement. Is there any way to, you've got some large patio spaces next to your pool, and I know you've got a patio up close to Kylie Drive, that's fine. but the one adjacent to the proposed house. So would there be any way to narrow that down?
I think the scale is deceiving. If you measure those patio spaces, they're, I don't know the exact footage off the top of my head, but they're like 14 feet-ish. So typically around a pool, on the north side of that pool, you'd like to see 12 feet to have a chaise lounge chair to actually be able to sit by your pool. So we've basically gone with the minimum requirements for laying out furniture. If you want to put a dining table there, up on the terrace right outside the door. So it is a very condensed space to begin with.
I don't think it's that. I disagree. If those flags are right and they're at 35.6 and they're within the rules, then I'm not comfortable with asking somebody to make their house smaller because we don't like how big it is.
The pool itself is also very small too. It's I would say it's small.
We tried to be transparent in the impervious area table. On that miscellaneous hardscape, we counted the stepping stones. We wanted to make sure we recorded everything.
Let's check the flag.
I would like to just get back to the easement issue and where exactly what exactly is going to occur on this side here. You know, I know you had mentioned something about passable, but I mean the way I read this is pretty clear. You know, it's a 10-foot easement. It's a proposed 10-foot wide trail easement. I mean, whether that's, you know, I think that's implicit in the whole easement is supposed to provide access to this area back here.
Are you under your impervious? What's your impervious numbers? You're under, right?
Yeah, we're under. Yeah.
What would be the,
thousand something.
You guys see how it's going here. I don't know, maybe you want to consider just going along that easement line and then opening up your driveway to a larger width, going out to the curb cut.
We're going to work
make it a little more maneuverable for getting in and out of that garage.
The reason why we went with the bump out is there's some telephone, electric, and cable TV stands right there.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to contact the electric company to see if we can relocate them elsewhere on the lot. So if that was the case, I don't think we have an issue straightening out that driveway and making it a straight in, straight out.
Yeah, I see the boxes now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that was just kind of put there as a concern.
It seems to be a bone of contention, so you guys should rethink that. I think we can
remove that in a short narrative. We don't have a problem trying to keep the trail open through all construction. That just says that, you know, during construction we'll set the hay bale line, you know, maybe 4 feet off the property line temporarily to keep, you know, passage going through during construction, and, you know, some caution tape on that to stop people from entering on the lot. And if it was grass, and mowed just to keep people through there, I don't think we'd have an issue doing that.
Okay.
The Dwyer family spent a lot of time, like I said, they are the neighbors next door. This is going to be kind of a family
compound.
Yeah, I guess that's it. So
last name Kennedy over there.
But, you know, so they're trying to make a house work in an area they want to be in Reading, they want to stay in Reading. So I mean they like the community, and they're trying to do what they can with this lot. He's owned it for a while with this intention. So, and, you know, making sure the trail markings go back up after construction. We don't have a problem with that. We don't have a problem with, you know, stoning a walk for the trail commission. You know, that's what they prefer to see.
I had one other thought. This is really, I think, maybe just to clarify on the plan. I don't know exactly how to say this. So you've got the drain pipe coming from the storm drains that flares out into the riprap on the right-hand side of the property, right on the property line there.
Yes.
And I don't know if we should consider that I know you're 35 feet away from that. Should we draw that 35-foot semicircle around that opening of the pipe so that it's clear that you're 35 feet away from the opening? If we want to call that a wetland.
Just because it had the standing water when you were there?
Well, so the pipe.
It's a retention basin. It's a retention basin for the subdivision.
The state exempts retention basins.
This whole thing back here.
The local ordinance exempts it, but the state does exempt man-made stormwater.
Yeah, is it number 18 to the right? Kylie? That in back of that house is got typhoon, everything, but it is a retention basin for the whole subdivision.
Right here it's labeled drain easement, and it kind of comes up in this area. That's why the trail.
So you don't think we have to mark the pipe? I mean, I think you're in compliance with it if we did.
It's exempt.
Okay, all right.
But it's interesting just as a note that this time of year, with how incredibly dry it is, it had 12 inches of standing water. That's astonishing to me. That must be fed by groundwater.
Well, it's half,
sustained
half,
by groundwater,
yeah.
Or, you know.
Half the street drains into it.
Some of the.
Well, yeah, but even still, there, I mean, it's I mean, I'd hate to see that retention basin
some
during a wet season.
This catch basin on the far
some
side.
Some of these detention ponds.
Must be really deep because it's going to there. It's lower there than
we
this
try and
here,
design
so
this
must be 6 or 8 feet deep.
So they're designed to intercept groundwater and stay wet.
Yep.
Because wetlands are excellent filters. The state allows, you know, a constructed wetland for stormwater.
I mean, it's a good design because it does reduce, it takes out pollutants.
And it's riprap lined, or is it?
I don't know.
No, it's just where it's coming out here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's probably just dirt.
So one last thought on the trail as it goes over the proposed driveway. This, no one else, maybe no one else likes this idea. You know how you paint a tennis court green? What if you paint that section of it green?
I think we're okay with just removing it.
So people understand that it's,
okay.
I don't know.
Because
it's really easy to, I'm sorry, but you know, you put a basketball hoop up and a couple of kids are out there playing basketball, to Chuck's point, you're gonna feel like you're walking through someone's ball game.
I'd feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And I'd defer to the Trails Committee on that.
I would prefer just to not see it in the easement, if we can make that work. But.
Okay.
I had a question about the area above the proposed retaining wall between the retaining wall and the pool. Is there going to be a fence on top of that retaining wall?
Yes, it's a tall wall.
There is? There's going to be a fence on top of that?
Mm-hmm.
And is that is area inside that retaining wall between there and the pool, is that like just
it's
grassed
planted.
And...
It's planted. They want a very
yeah.
natural look to the pool,
yeah.
even though it's a rectilinear shape. They want as much green space around the pool as possible.
So they're going to landscape that inside.
Yes, landscape.
Just asking.
Mm-hmm.
How tall is that wall?
It is 10 feet.
At its highest.
At its
cool.
highest
yeah,
point
at
the back?
Point, and then it cuts
so
into
the
slope.
So in the back of the... kind of close to that 198 line, it's going to be 10 feet.
Eight feet.
Yeah, so
206 at the
well,
top.
I don't know.
And
I
then 196.
I know I can't see all these numbers. There's a lot.
Yeah, about 10 feet
it's
down
a lot of numbers
the corner here. And then it gets progressively smaller. The idea is to keep it level with the fence on top of the decorative fence. And, while you're out there, I'm sure you saw Mr. Dodwell's current home and seen the landscaping out there.
Yeah. So none of those decks and none of those are going to have access to the backyard? No stairways down and no...
There is one stairway down.
Is that shown?
It's right here and it cuts, the stairway goes down under the screen porch to access the pool equipment. So the pool equipment is actually under the screen porch and not another impervious thing off the side.
Right.
That was an intent.
Oh, okay, so it's going to go through the word deck there,
yes,
maybe?
Yes, there's a staircase that goes under the deck, right through the word deck, exactly.
Okay.
There was a lot going on, so we just tried to show that.
No, I understand. Just asking.
That way, too, the people servicing the pool equipment do not have to walk around the house and through the resource. They can go
yeah.
directly under.
Yep.
Any questions?
Nope. Looks like there's one additional tree that's probably going to be taken out just to do the driveway.
Yep.
Which one was that? Do you, anybody know what kind? And
what's a street
looks
tree?
Small white
big.
Pine.
A street tree.
Yeah, no, it wasn't a pine. Pines are real long
yeah.
here.
Up on the up near the edge of the street.
Pine fell along his windows.
Could
what
be.
What got planted? I don't know, but
they're small at
yeah.
this stage. Yeah.
At this stage, you may be able to relocate it because they're still fairly small.
The street tree?
Yeah.
Yes, we can try our best to move it. It depends on the quality of the root zone.
Mm.
Those are the only two trees being removed, correct? Because I know it's getting pretty close. It was tough to tell, but actually, yeah.
I won't forget this
yeah,
time.
Okay.
Yeah. Any comments from the public? Mr. Finch?
Yeah, Will Finch. I live at 51 Mill Street in Reading, and a member of the Trails. Also, I was very active in establishing this trail easement and getting some of the signs up, and we worked with the landowner to accommodate his requests, you know, keep the markers to a minimum. I do appreciate the offer of not paving in the trail easement. Certainly, paving in the easement, I don't think would meet the spirit of the easement. Even though the language of the easement is not quite as tight as it should have been. And in terms of the request to shift the trail within the easement is certainly doable, but as we requested in number 6 of our letter to you, permanent above grade markers should be installed, especially at the turning points of the easement, so that we can be clear how far we can actually move that trail without getting outside of the easement. There were some, the town surveyed the easement years ago, but they're just wooden stakes and many of them have been lost. And so when we put our current signs in, we know we're near the middle of the easement, but we're not really sure of the boundaries. And we had 10 feet to work with. We were being careful to stay in the middle. So,
so
I think permanent markers would
yes,
there
was
still definitely help
no,
little. Us. Stay within the easement, and also be clear to all homeowners, how the neighboring home, as well as you folks, where we should be staying. We did request some plantings to try and buffer, between the trail and the foundation of your garage. So certainly appreciate any measures that you could do in that respect. Yeah, we're certainly willing to, to work with the homeowner on this project and keep us in the loop, and I think it'll work out okay.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think considering the conversation about going out and taking a look at the wetland boundaries, I think it wouldn't hurt considering the commission is looking at the easement to just go over that with Hayes when you're out there, what the location looks like or if there is some movement where it could potentially be. But I think we can handle that when we actually have that site visit.
Yeah.
So, to stake out that easement, I don't think is a huge effort. It's on the definitive plan.
Okay.
So we will continue.
Let me just say one thing.
Sure.
For this site, when we're talking about our bylaw, the Wetlands Protection Act, you've maximized this site with imperviousness by zoning standards. Okay. But the Wetlands Protection Act, it reacts to anything that's in the buffer zone as a problem for the resource area. So I see a lot of house, a lot of driveway, and I see no mitigation. there's, you've offered no mitigation for this disturbance. And where's the balance here? You are going to have to come back and mitigate to the size of that house. You know, whether it's planting, whether it's something else, but you have to come back and do something. You can't just say, hey, look, we can fit this in and it works. Because we need some plants, we need, I'm not going to come up with it for you. You need to look at this. A bunch of stuff have come up tonight, but you can't just drop this in.
Conceptual landscape plan where we show areas of plantings that we may not have exact species, but native species with some examples. You know, I think the landscaping here is
well,
a lot of effort that's going to
we're looking for an improvement. So what's out there? What does your evaluation say? What shouldn't be there? You know, Norway maple, buckthorn, something like that, and how are you going to improve it? I mean, that's how you would do the plantings. I mean, I'm not just talking about what it looks like when you're looking out in the backyard. So I really think you need to concentrate on that, because if you want this size house, you need to come up with that much mitigation for that disturbance and sort of keeping things equal. So just look at that also.
Just wanted to bring up a point. I mean, I think you're right. It's deceiving, isn't it? The way it's very deceiving. And so it looks like a really big house. You're right. But you'll be surprised if you look at all the other houses on the lot or on our cul-de-sac. This is going to be probably maybe two-thirds the size, maybe even half. It's certainly going to be half the size of my existing home. And so, well and good. I mean, we can make the house smaller if that's the only way we can get a house on the property. But keep in mind, it's going to look, you know, talk about spirit. I mean, in spirit of the neighborhood, it's going to look like, you know, sort of a, you know, almost like a pool house rather than a house per se. So you do have to keep that in mind. And this is probably the smallest lot, isn't that right? This is the smallest lot on the entire.
What I said doesn't mean you need to make your house smaller.
No,
that's one thing. But you have a big section of that property that, you know. You haven't looked at to how you could make improvements on. Maybe Libby needs to go back out there and identify some problems that can
some invasive
work
species
out.
That we could remove or
I mean, I think it would go a long way to make this trail easement work for everyone. But again, the second thing is the mitigation.
It doesn't exclude, you know, in what Chuck's saying, it doesn't exclude looking at some other areas of where we could improve on this property. Just ask you to take a second.
So I have, if you are done, I have, I don't even know why I wrote that. So let's skip that first one. Some plans. Does anyone want to see what that retaining wall looks like, 10 foot high, anything like that? Planting plan?
Planting
plan. I think
plan.
I just asked for that.
Yep.
Okay. Retaining wall, didn't have a mind about that.
I think the retaining wall, it's it being right on that 35 no build. Yeah, I think
I almost feel like I can't really see these plans too well, even on that, but if the commission's fine with it, then it's fine. And then the other thing, I just figured out what I was asking for. Libby may have some field data forms. Can we get those submitted?
Board's open to us, where this shows the entire lot, resubmission, I don't mind going up to a 10 scale.
Yeah.
With the understanding that this entire lot
can't be on it, yeah. Yeah, we'll have this one.
My thing is making sure that, to your point, is we need some mitigation, but making sure the flags are right early rather than having a surprise later is a good idea. The other question, I guess, just I have towards the end of this is, in the process of doing the construction, where things will be stored, where soil will be, you know, if you're digging 6 inches from the no build, just, you know, we don't want to see a mound of dirt in the 25, that kind of thing.
We've discussed stockpiling areas. There are areas on the adjacent lot, which is also owned by the applicant,
okay,
that are outside the 100-foot buffer that.
Okay.
You can stockpile and put a double row of hay bales around.
Okay. I think that'll be an important part of the plan once we get to that stage.
Did you talk to the town engineer about grading over his easement?
The drainage easement?
Yeah, the pipe. It looks like you have you're grading over that area. Did you have a discussion with him?
We did not. We did see the plans to him.
I did see the black pipes out there.
We're tying into the existing
litter.
Grade.
Just litter?
It's just a long pipe.
Yeah.
Over the pipe.
There were two of them.
So we're matching that grade?
What?
Well, it looks like it goes right to the property line, but
bless
you. Thank you.
It kind of matches right on top of the pipe.
Right. Well, if you could just send Ryan a copy,
yeah,
that would, just
problem.
To make sure.
And we have, so and you're infiltrating on this site?
First half inch over the roof. It's designed to be.
What are you using?
Caltech recharged 280 inch.
And you have an operation maintenance plan for that?
We can spend one for it. It's the standard manufacturer's one of both right now.
We typically require calculations as well?
That's on the plan.
Okay.
Yes.
It's over to the regular one.
So with the manufacturer's operation maintenance plans, can you just kind of bring it home and put some dates on it for yearly or
yeah, we'll do a little
annual?
Checklist and
yeah. Okay, great.
Do I have a motion to continue the hearing?
I'll make a motion to continue.
Second.
All those in favor? When do you think Libby would be available?
I could shoot her an email and find out.
Yes,
I actually thought she was going to be at our site visit yesterday, but yes. But I'll send her an email. She's pretty responsive.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is Shackford Road. It's not on this agenda. It just ended up in our head. Okay, public hearing for 45 Shackford Road, notice of intent 270 dash, we don't have a DEP number yet. Map 12, lot 75, Spinazzola is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, and the, as amended in the General Reading Bylaw, Section 7.1. Applicant will present the proposal. Commission receives reports. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation, starting on my right.
David Pinnett.
Al Couillard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tirone, Conservation Administrator. I don't have Shackford or the next one on here, so I could go down and grab those again.
I don't know that we need it.
Do we need,
really need it.
Do you need the plan?
I remember it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've got it.
We have it.
Yeah, we have it.
That's good. So I'm going to one ounce tape it to the...
Do you want a copy, Mr. Sullivan?
Thank you. For the record, I'm Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group, and I'm here with the owners, the Spinazzolas, who are in the back row. And what they'd like to do is they have an existing single-family home. They'd like to put an addition to the rear of the house. They're going to look to keep the existing deck in the rear yard. And off of that deck, they're going to reconfigure a platform and a set of steps down to grade. This site is within 200 feet of Walker's Brook, which is a perennial river. And the wetland flagging shown up until the fence line was actually the wetland flags that were hung and I believe approved for 56 Cross Street. I think I see the owners here tonight. So we use those as part of our designs. I think you've already had
give them a discount?
So the bank flags and the flags up to 7A were marked onto this site. I added an 8A over by where the 12-inch pipe outlet is. So the situation, there's no trees to be cut. We're well outside the 35-foot no structure zone. There's really no grading changes as well. There's an existing walkout basement. There's actually a step out of the basement up to the backyard grade. The addition will have the same feature. There'll be one step. There'll be a full basement, but there'll be a step up so you can exit out to the rear yard. I tried to show the construction entrance. We showed the erosion control areas. It will be a full foundation. But basically, it's just a glorified frost wall for this, where it's a walkout. They'll be going down 4 feet, and all material will have to be trucked out. I didn't show a stockpile area. There's been very little room to work back in there, but there'd be very little material that would need to come out for this addition. I did show, to provide some drainage mitigation, I did show a crushed stone drip trench along the drip edge of the proposed roof. I did do an alternatives analysis for the riverfront area. There's really not that many alternatives for this site. They did look at going from a one-story structure to a two-story to keep the same footprint. That really didn't work for their situation. They have three small children under the age of 10. And it's going over, the addition's going over a previously disturbed area. And like I said, there's no trees to be cut as part of this project. And there is the 500-year floodplain. There's no 100-year floodplain associated with this site. That's not a jurisdictional floodplain, but I do show it as a Zone X floodplain out behind the fence area. And I'll turn it over to the commission for any questions they might have.
I noticed some unauthorized excavation in the backyard.
Lucy.
The dog.
Yeah.
Remember?
Enter at your own risk.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Stop it, born.
It looked pretty straightforward, and we saw the flag, and there is a opening in the gate over the easement, which you have to have, I guess, by law. And it's very flat also back there as well.
Yeah, it's a flat area.
Yeah, real flat.
It was strange, like Anika was saying in a previous hearing, you can walk the Walker's Brook. It's just a dry bed. I walked the whole thing. I'm like, this is crazy. But it was totally bone dry. I know it's perennial, I'm not, but it was bone dry.
Yeah, it's rare that happens back there. So for construction here purposes, is the chain link fence going to be sort of taken down to provide access? There's a 4-foot chain link fence?
Well, there's a section that ties back into the house. It looks
on the right and left.
So there's a section of chain link fence that would be taken out, but the section along the side lot line would remain in place.
Yeah, okay. Well, I didn't have any questions. I read the alternatives analysis. It seemed reasonable. I didn't have any questions.
You folks didn't make it to?
No, we did.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we might.
Yes. You guys
nothing.
Didn't, yeah, in your report,
yeah.
You said it was pretty straightforward.
Yeah,
Chuck, do you have any,
it's good to go.
Anything further?
So I did have a question. So typically, Jack, we have in the past, and we were talking about this during my sidewalk, which was with Becky and Mike, about the recharge that you're doing. And I did talk to Ryan about that. And he recommended not doing drip trenches or not having us approve drip trenches unless it was just for a garage. And he said that he wasn't sure the volume was enough to hold the capacity. And he said that most of these things on the downspout has a relief valve or something like that, so it's not really working. So outside of that, because that's not what we're really talking about, but consistency with other projects, we were wondering if you would propose a some sort of cultric chamber like he did on the other,
right,
the other property.
I have a good answer for that. As Rebecca stated, this backyard is extremely flat, really out to the fence line, and that the wetland line's right beyond that fence, and the groundwater table is probably only down 12 or 18 inches in the backyard. So I purposely,
yeah, that seems
a typical dry well, even a mini dry well, is like 3 inches in height. And when you put it underground and you try to run a pipe to it, it would be in a saturated condition. Nothing would, it wouldn't work. It would back up and it would just drain out. So in this case, on my next hearing, I did propose a dry well because I have the elevation
mm-hmm.
difference I can work with.
Mm-hmm.
But on this site, I'm very limited. I wanted to show some mitigation for drainage, but I could put a dry well in, but it would be in a saturated condition. It wouldn't be effective.
How effective do you think the drip trench is going to be?
Well, I mean, if the groundwater table's down 12 or 18 inches, we'll get some, it would at least pick it up, and you'd have some storage volume in that stone. I don't know what else I could really do in this situation with such a high groundwater table for drainage.
It is, you know, from the site walk, I mean, it is very wet in the back corner where the chain link fence is.
Sure,
you can even
yeah.
see. So, I mean, that makes sense to me.
Yeah,
I mean, that makes sense to me.
And that was my reasoning, only because of the high groundwater table. On all of the projects, I'd propose a dry well or cul-de-sac.
Is that addition to shed roof?
David, do you know that answer? The addition, is it a shed roof? Or do you not know?
It's going to be the same roof line as the front one on the side there.
It's a gable yes. facing the rear yard.
So wherever the drip line is, they'll have to
okay.
put the drip trench. And I didn't have the finished architectural plans. I just had a footprint. But the intent would be wherever the drip line is, there'd be a drip trench along that drip line.
Just one side of it would be the deck.
If it's underneath the deck slotted, they'd have to put some crushed stone underneath the deck at a minimum. So we'll try to provide something to work. I'm fine if that's a condition.
Any further questions from the commission? Any questions from the public? Hearing none?
Can we leave this open till the next hearing?
Because we don't have a DEP file number.
Yeah.
Do I hear a motion?
I move we continue this to the next hearing, which, forget the date, it's October
19th.
Is that the one that we're moving?
I thought it was still the 19th. What is the next meeting?
Not on my
iPad. Whatever that next meeting is, I propose we move it to that.
Just for my client's sake, would the order be ready at the next hearing? Would we need to attend the hearing?
I don't see a reason.
I would encourage you to look at the order of conditions.
Before.
Right. And Chuck, you could send that, correct?
I can, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, that works.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
So there's a motion to continue.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Sure.
Yeah? Okay. Thank you very
Thank you.
Much. Okay, moving right along.
19th and 26th.
The 19th, I thought. Yeah.
Yeah, because we can't do the 5th.
Right. Public hearing for notice of, we don't have a DEP file number for Milepost Road. Is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaw, Section 7.1. Applicant will present proposal, commission will receive reports, commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and public will be given the opportunity to ask questions. I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
David Pinnett.
Hey, thank you. Again, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm over at the Sullivan Engineering Group, and I've just met my clients for the first time. They're behind me, Mayo's. And what they're basically looking to do is they're looking to construct an addition to the rear of their house. As you can see on the plan, there's a stone retaining wall to the back left of the house. There's an existing deck with stairways. What they're basically looking to do is add a small addition and then also have a series of steps and platforms and extend the deck out towards the wetland line. Norse Environmental flagged the wetlands. This site's tighter than the last one. The proposed deck, we're just a shade over 35 feet from the deck to the wetland line. But the wetland line was pretty pronounced with the grade change in the rear yard. And with this project as well, there'll be no trees to be cut. There is a little bit of transitional grading that's required to the rear of the addition. And for this project, for the roof addition, we're showing roof drains that would be conveyed to a 500-gallon dry well with 12 inches of crushed stone surrounding. Again, this site did not have a DEP file number. I did show a construction entrance, which would be on the right-hand side of the house, and I show erosion control to run that right sideline for erosion measures and to protect the abutting property during construction. And again, this is a, it's not a walkout basement, but there's very little grading that's required in the back. Is it a walkout?
Yeah.
Oh, it is a walkout basement in the back. So even though I do have a little bit of transitional grading needed to match into the existing slope in the rear yard, but very little site work. And then I also made a note that there's an existing play structure that's either going to be removed from the property or it will be relocated outside of the 35-foot no structure zone. There's very little room to put it where I'm showing the dry well, so it may have to be removed.
Those girls are too old for that anyway.
I will.
Dad,
is the gentleman gone?
So that's something we had talked about by email that, you know, it either has to be relocated or removed.
It'll be removed.
Okay, yeah. It'll be removed.
Just for sake of the conversation, I don't know that that's would consider that a structure, you know, any different than a shed. There's no, I know Al, but the way I see that, it's a swing set. There's no play area associated with it.
No, I agree. If they want to keep it, they could keep it, I think.
If it is something that can,
I think the girls should have to appeal to the commission to keep their swing set.
Yeah,
exactly. I think that's a good idea.
One later.
Now, one thing I did not do any sort of drainage calculations for the dry well. It's a small addition. I could provide drainage calculations. We're going to be continued anyways to show.
500 gallons. I don't know if that's big enough.
Yeah. for that small roof area. So I thought it was sufficient, but I didn't provide any calculations.
If it's not, we should all start building a boat.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. So we had a site visit Tuesday evening. You didn't make it to this one.
Yes, we did.
Oh, yep. You did? Okay.
Made it.
No,
it hurts.
What didn't you make it to?
Pearl Street and
Mariano Drive.
Oh.
Sure. Jack, I have a question.
One.
The deck that's going to be encompassed into the existing family room, is that also going to drain into the drywall structure as well?
The deck will not, because it'll be slotted. There's no roof on top of that.
It says here that you have the existing deck to be removed, family room to be expanded into this area.
Oh, right.
The deck that's currently off the family room.
Yeah.
Says that's
not
going to be
part
of the...
Not the new deck, but the existing...
Not the new deck, the existing deck that's going to be part of the family room.
You're right, you're correct. Sorry, I'm reading it on a phone. You're correct. Where that deck would be, the family room's getting extended
mm-hmm.
over to that area, that would be...
It'll be discharged into the...
Into the dry well as well.
Okay.
Any new construction with a roof on it, we propose to capture.
Okay. And we did take an inspection in that area in the back. It's all grassed almost down to the natural vegetation line with the flags A5 through A2 are located. And there was some excavation, but they cut in about 2 or 3 inches the next door neighbors into their property in back of the existing shed. And they also had, so it looked like they're putting landscaping in the back there. Wouldn't be grass. You wouldn't cut it and then take out the existing grass. So. Any other questions from the commission?
Yeah, I just want to make sure that if there's a storm drain down gradient from that construction entrance, that you put silt sack in that?
Yes.
Yep. Would they continue anyway because we don't have a DEP file number?
Mm-hmm. So I hear a motion. Any comments from the public? What?
Are you asking for drainage calculations? I kind of, with the banter, I didn't understand if you were.
I think it's.
No, I think
it's pretty over designed.
I think by inspection, it's okay.
It should be okay. Any comments from the public? It's just time, ladies.
They're happy they get to stay up late.
I was just going to say.
Well, they're having a blast. This is awesome.
Not what they expected.
Go home and go to bed.
You guys don't want to put your 2 cents in about the swing set?
It's going to be rough tomorrow morning.
This is your chance.
Sure.
You're on your own on that one.
Yeah.
Do we have a motion?
Make a motion to continue.
Second.
Second.
Go ahead. All those in favor?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you
very much.
Sorry, so late.
Okay, thanks. Yeah. Okay.
Oh, and you are today, tonight, too?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Night.
Al. Not that it matters, but I might want to declare.
Oh, why? Because is it a butter?
Yeah. Not that you need to accuse yourself, but just to let him know.
Yeah, let him know.
He didn't even know where the street was. We're driving all. We tell him take a left on Main Street. He goes right. It's like, he's in your backyard, Al.
We're in their backyard. He goes, show my new man cave.
I didn't even know where I was.
Old new business. Determination of applicability, 7 Washington Street.
Yeah.
What happened with it?
I like that. Beck getting right into finishing up here.
We're not doing Pearl Street?
No. Okay, I'm sorry. It got into our packets.
Oh, okay.
It's going to be the next meeting.
Okay. Next
sorry,
meeting. Okay.
Everybody. It just happened. So.
That's okay.
See, you're ahead of the game already. You reviewed it. And
how about that? No, we didn't. That's the one we didn't go to.
We didn't go to
we were prescient. So 7 Washington Street.
Side setback to nose
setback. 7 Washington Street. 7.
That's the one with the
boat.
Yes.
The shark ate. What? So, that was an RDA,
yes,
right?
Yes.
We're just signing?
Sorry, negative determination that we're already.
We already made a negative determination.
Yes.
Half the distance.
Did you have an email?
Beside or in front of the.
Yeah, I did.
5 feet if it's behind
it. I said.
Behind. This is behind. Yeah, so 5 feet.
Are we going to go?
Yeah.
All right. Awesome.
Yeah.
Did that change?
If it ever closes.
Yes.
6 feet.
If the water rises.
I don't think so. It's been like that since I've been
wow.
here for 8 or 9 years.
I wouldn't do it. I did the Saco on Saturday. I ground it out so many times.
We're going to Bridgeton this weekend.
Where are you going?
Oh, sweet.
We're renting a house on
Moose Pond?
Wood Pond.
Oh.
Which is, do you know where that is?
No, I know where Moose Pond is.
Wood Pond is it's just not far from the center of town. It's a little smaller barn. Apparently it's a big house. We're scoping it out to see if we want to get a game together and go there next summer. Nice town, Bridgeton.
It is. We have a place in Fryeburg.
Yeah.
That's nice too, but it's not. There's a lot more going on in Bridgeton. You know, downtown.
Really?
Yeah.
We're going to the Fryeburg Fair Sunday.
Ugh.
Just to humor my wife.
Is that now?
Yes, it's this Sunday.
It's for a while, right? Or is it just?
It goes for a week.
Deerfield Fair is this weekend too.
Oh, is it?
Deerfield?
Yes.
It's this weekend. It's tomorrow and to Sunday, I think.
We're done with the enforcement order, right?
Yep.
What do we need to do with that?
Just leave it on there. It's still in effect.
All right. And then we have a continued certificate of compliance for 270-0625. Mariano Drive, 92 Sanborn Lane, Lot 3, Al Couliard.
So.
Any grass there?
Miracles do happen. Without any effort, the grass grew in. I think you did take care of.
Really?
Someone had to take care of the erosion because there was a lot.
Well, and there was a spot that looked like it got kinda
washed away, yeah.
Well, and even just filled in a little bit or there.
Come on, I'm going to Florida. Just give me my money.
Don't spend it all at the racetrack.
Yeah, so we met with the owner and we inspected the area and grass seems to have come.
Meet with him or her?
Her. Shayna.
Shayna. She's nice. She's really nice.
Yeah. And it looked like the grass had come in on the area, if you're looking down to the wetland on the left side of the house, and the back looked good. And then on the other side of the house, there had been some quite a bit of erosion, and they actually filled that kind of gully in with some dirt. And I think there's a little bit of grass growing in, and I think that will establish itself. And a tiny little bit of rock, but it wasn't significant, just a little, like that much. So
anything that existed, it was far up the hill, and,
yeah.
And there's a lot of grass in between.
Yeah, that's true.
In
yep.
Between that and there, and it's ill. And
so,
do you want to ask the applicant not to do this again? It's
serious.
Really, it's really nice. I don't think you understand how incredibly proud I am that there's only like one certificate of compliance. It's not this one, it's another one that's hanging out there. We usually get them right away, which is not something that most towns can do. And I think it's working really well with our cooperation from the building department. And so, anyways, I don't know what happened, but maybe you shouldn't sell them so quickly so you can get the lawn established. Why don't you make that a goal?
Stop being so efficient.
Sell the house until the lawn's established.
You see how good the big yellow house looked? The other one?
The one in front?
Yeah.
Is that the yellow one?
Well, it's not really. I guess it's beige.
Yeah.
Yeah, the big three-car garage.
Yeah.
I did see that. That's the first time I've seen it since it was done.
Just signed a P&S on that 2 days ago. Finally out of that Mariano. Should have stuck with the plan. 3,600 square feet, gone. Oh no, Al's got to build bigger and grander. Wait 2 years.
What about the rest of the road there? Isn't there one more layer of pavement going on?
Yeah, now that that's sold, I'll raise the manholes and put the binder on and finish up. I had a bond there from the original bond, and on the 26th, I had that reduced from, I think, 3-something down to 60 or 70, and now I'll put that top coat on and clean that up.
Al, I can't remember. Did we ask you to provide any documentation about that tree in the middle of the cul-de-sac? Its survivability, I mean, it looked fine, but I was just wondering.
I don't think you asked me to provide anything, but I think I told you I did. I fertilized it, I trimmed it,
fertilizer that had northeast come in and look at it. And I took Keating's advice on the cul-de-sac to not bury the roots. That's why that cul-de-sac is sloping down and the wall sloping down, and you want to stress the roots. So you said you don't really like that. You don't have a lot of faith in that pan from northeast tree. I don't really know, but she told me the tree was about 150 years old and it's probably going to live to about 250. For what that's worth, I don't know.
For the record, I think Pam's fantastic.
Oh, I forgot.
I probably their best person. Probably will inherit the company. And that tree that's way over. Is that one replaced? It's way over. It's actually off 4th Street.
Off Forest Street?
Yeah.
Off Sanborn?
No, we're way over on 4th Street where that tree isn't put on the, what's that one called? What's your other cul-de-sac, your other project over there on 4th Street? You know the tree I always ask for?
Bethune.
Bethune.
Way? I gave you that tree 2 years ago. You keep asking me for it.
It's not there. You put it somewhere else.
Okay.
I've heard the same conversation over and over again.
Is that part of the certificate?
So we got
no.
We got a.
It's not.
Well, it's going to be the next
this
item.
Maybe
stop
to
get $250 out of
it. You could just donate to the.
Just donate to the fund. Just donate to the fund.
All right, so
a motion to approve the certificate of compliance for Mariano Drive, lot 3.
Do I? Yep. All those in favor? Okay.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Stay there. Can I get another motion to release the bond for this $5,000 bond?
Okay.
I thought we released the bond with the second one because of the...
No, each one did a bond separately.
Okay.
And the road has a bond as well.
I make a motion to release the bond.
Already.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. Now you can go to Flora. What?
Can I send Al an enforcement order to get a tree over at Bethune?
No. You can't.
You accused yourself.
I can still speak from this side.
I want a tree there. It's part of the original plan. It was part of his original count that he had to replace all the trees. I think he has every intention of doing it. It just hasn't happened.
I'm telling you, what if I get you the receipt? I'll dig out the receipt.
No, I want to see an alive tree right there.
Do we have the plan and the...
Yeah, we have a plan. So they're very... they're spaced evenly.
They're
and it's like one, two, nothing, one, two, three, one, two, three. You know, it's like everything is spaced evenly. You can see where it is and you can see that the depression in the grass. Not that I've been there lately, but that's the way it was. And that you said when you bought the trees for Sanborn, you would put one here.
I know I replaced the landscape.
Well, you do have two options now.
That tree. It's the same landscape, but I still use them. It's a swamp maple. That's the particular trees you guys wanted on the edge of that wetlands.
That one wetland.
Swamp maples, I think. If I recall, there were five of them.
The one I'm talking about is a street tree.
Yeah, it's about 17 or 20 feet.
The ones you are talking about are... No, this one's right next to the road, right by Ed's... What's his? Carlo? Ed Callow's? That's the tree I'm talking about. So you never knew which tree I was talking about, it sounds like.
Well, one was dead. I knew which one it was.
Yeah, well, that one by Eddie Callow's driveway's... dead too, and that's the one I've been. I don't know if it's missing. Yeah, it's been really okay.
There, it's missing. Eddie Callow dug it up, I bet.
Well, I started asking you about that tree when we had
the tree you were asking
we
about.
We had
under
the certificate of compliance, or you were under the order of conditions, and that was the tree we were talking about, the street tree. So that needs to be replaced, Al. I mean, you said you would replace it.
I did replace it.
No, now you're just talking about the swamp maple.
I replaced the swamp maple.
Yeah.
Now you think there's a street tree missing.
I don't think. That's the one I was always talking about.
Why don't the two of you go out to Bethune?
Right.
And take a look at the location?
Really, yeah.
At
okay.
And update us at the next...
I love going on trips with Chuck.
Update us at the next meeting with old,
I do too,
old new business.
Those good cars and all that stuff that I don't regularly get into. I'm available and usually just, if you want to just give me a call, sure, or meet out there, whatever you want to do.
Afterwards.
And I'll report back.
You've got a clubhouse you can go to.
What's tomorrow, Thursday?
Tomorrow's Thursday.
Anytime tomorrow.
All right.
Nine.
You know, you have an option. There's a certain bit of cachet that comes with being the first one to do something.
Yeah, the cachet, it's too much cachet.
What do you say we give him back $250 less than his money?
Close this out. I want to go back
over there.
I think we're done with this conversation.
Done. Yeah.
Administrator's report? No permits, emergency permits.
In the minutes. I'll give you a report on the minutes if I could do that.
Okay.
So it's been tough to do the minutes in our last two meetings because of all the action and kind of, I guess, just the magnitude of each one of those, the permits that came in. So before that, I was having a good time and it was easy to do, but they've been a little bit late. So I really want to try to make this work with the minutes with me doing that, but you know, right now it's been a little bit tough. So, and I'm also, Ann was gone for 2 weeks, so she's helpful with the minutes also. So we'll probably have two batches of minutes for our next meeting.
I can imagine this one is going to be difficult.
Yeah, but that was more or less like when the town says, how's it going with minutes? We really need to have a conversation whether it is working. And if it's working, I'll tell you. I don't have a problem doing the minutes. But if it's not, then you know, we have to remember that.
Okay.
You know, it could be another option to have a minutes take. Okay.
Okay. So that's it. Any open? This is our coffee clatch time. Remember John Halsey at that meeting? Did the selectmen have this? I don't know. I guess time at the end of the meeting that I don't know where they find the time, but they talk about general things. So
talk about something. That building should have an enforcement order. Are you kidding me? You guys are talking about putting logs in there? That guy hasn't maintained his silt fence. I walked out there, so this is an enforcement order. This is a shit show. It's horrible. I thought that was horrible. Well, that was a horrible sight. I didn't think he made any effort at all to protect that wetlands. I think he should have got an enforcement order tonight, and he should have had a plan before us at the next meeting. To shore up that bank, to tell us how he's going to fix the building, how he's going to plan. I mean, you come in here, one piece of paper with a log on it, I'm going to put logs in it. That guy was going to put logs in there properly?
He isn't.
Are you kidding me?
Well, that's why I want Chuck to be notified and want him out there when it happens. The bank, the stream, has nothing to do with them.
For what
no.
we... What
you hearing what he's saying though? That's,
he submitted. That's a lot of work. I know Chuck will go out there, but it's
No. It's not their bank to fix.
It's not their
I don't erosion issue.
I don't get that. How can it not be their erosion issue?
Oh,
it's on their
thanks.
Property.
The town has an easement on
that. Well,
they're required
the
to maintain it.
Did he put up the silt fence to protect it in the first place?
He put the silt fence.
Isn't it in his order to protect it?
The silt fence has nothing to do with why that's eroding, though. That's eroding because water was getting flowing down the stream.
Every time in my history, I've heard hundreds of boards like this say, we don't care how it happened. It happened. It's there. It needs to be repaired. I've heard that 1,000 times in the last 30 years.
Well, he's repairing it.
Let him try.
Repairing it with a couple of logs and a piece of paper. I don't get
it.
That was, Chuck, wasn't that bank horrible?
It was.
That's 30 feet in both directions.
I mean,
you're not going to get anything to grow on that bank.
That was a tough site. I mean, I don't know if
you
know the
history. No, I get that it was a tough site.
You know the history?
It was
a cleanup site.
Building, clean up.
Yeah,
I know
it was all that. No one wanted it. This guy comes in. It's a tough site, tough person to work with, you know. It's coming together. We're almost at the finish line. let's, you know, it has been, this site from the beginning has been something that really needed to walk these guys through it. And it's almost over, and I've been doing a lot of the walking, you know, and getting these things finished. And it's taken this long. And that's the way these particular people are working. It's going to take me to go out there and help them do it. And I think that they're gonna they don't have a problem with the money. They don't have a problem with providing labor. They want to do it. But the point, you're saying they should get an enforcement order with that. I mean, I'm not convinced of that. I'm not convinced it's their fault. And, you know, so you got to convince five other people. I don't think that that's a problem that they have. I mean, no runoff is coming from their site causing that. It's coming from the velocity of the stream.
The whole thing was runoff. Did you stand there? Did you see runoff?
Not
coming from that crushed stone and the gravel parking lot and the corner of that building.
The only issue I had was
there was runoff
big puddle
all along there.
The issue is the gutters. That was my issue.
And there was runoff going underneath the chain link fence.
The guy moves slow, so we can't really ask him to put gutters on.
I just asked him. He said he's going to put gutters on.
Well, there's not going to be gutters
help.
On that building.
We're
it's
all
a,
going
up
sad. There was some
he just told me there's
going to
be gutters.
Gutters on for him.
Well, I remember that. I remember you asking that and him answering the question, but the real answer is it's a parapet roof and there are no gutters. When you walked on the left-hand side of the building, there's a big PVC pipe coming out of the wall.
Right.
That's it. That's the gutter.
Well, why did we see a drip line?
I don't know.
No, wait a minute.
There's a drip line
on
the rear of the building.
What do you mean the PVC?
There's a PVC pipe coming out of the wall at the base of the building. That's the gutters coming down.
Oh, we saw a PVC pipe that was uncovered, right? It looked like a pipe that a gutter downspout was going to go in.
I'll look when I'm out there. I didn't see that. They're not doing gutters like in a house. It's a roof drain. Drains to the center or however it works, and it gets down
through the
building and then out, and then into the infiltration chamber.
Well, I wish he had said that instead of saying yes.
Well, he did, but that's the problem. He did say it. These people aren't.
Well, I thought it was a pretty easy question to answer.
I don't want to say.
Are there going
to
be gutters on?
They're not.
Okay, that's fine.
They get the gutters.
So, I mean, you guys are talking about two different things. So, water eroding off the building is there isn't water coming off the building. It's going through the internal drain.
Yeah.
That was my issue, because from where I was standing, I couldn't tell that, and I couldn't see gutters. The parking lot doesn't appear to slope towards the river. What?
That's good, because we want it to slope towards the drain that's in the
right.
The, yeah. Yeah.
So it's like the lot isn't draining into
the lot is here, and then there's the topography goes up a little, but then there's the crushed stone and those dead plants.
Yeah.
And that's probably about 14 feet. And that's all going right into the river. The silt fence isn't started. Silt fence gone and eroded.
You don't see like erosion channels.
No, I don't think there's water coming over that berm though.
I'm gonna drive out there tomorrow because I'll take some pictures. I saw erosion channels in there.
It was a little bit coming through that temporary chain link fence.
I didn't see any effort to try and make that thing better. It looked like it was old and rotted. It looked like a violation to me.
You probably should have said that I'm just suggesting you could have just said, well, why we don't have to give everyone a violation. You could have just said, look, I was out there and I saw this and I'm concerned about it. So just could you just add some erosion control in this one little area? I mean, you could have said that.
Well, when we talked out there, I thought the site needed more than that. And my thought when I was out there on the site visit was, you know, I don't want to design a plan for this applicant to fix a mess that he's ignored for
he has a
so
plan,
many
though.
Years.
They have a top-notch professional plan. It was done by O'Connell, R.J. O'Connell. Yeah.
Well, they're not following it.
Well, they're just doing it slowly. It's like instead of the guy buying, like having whatever lumberyard drop off all the supplies to do the house at once, they're just going back and forth themselves and picking up what they need, so that they, you know, in the next 3 weeks we can do this, or the next this today we'll get enough material to put down, you know, 100 square feet of tile. So they're doing it like that, piecemeal, whatever you call it. So everything's kind of slow, and they haven't really thought of the outside. But if you go by tomorrow and you say, look, I absolutely want new erosion control. I mean, I hate that construction fencing, that orange construction fencing, because it's not even holding up that stuff. And those rocks, I'd prefer to have, you know, moss back there myself.
Well, right. I mean,
I wish they asked us about that.
I had the same reaction, because I looked at it and I said, you know, you saw the pictures, is the fence is holding up the rocks. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But when you started saying, well, they put the rock down because the bank was washing out, and they just put it there to minimize.
I just didn't see a lot of effort.
Yeah, I don't know what that was all about.
I didn't see a lot of effort by them to do anything substantial.
But I do think, I don't think the logs are going to work, because I do think that it gets awful narrow at the corner of the building, and it's just going to wash it right back away. But you got to do something. I mean, you almost need an armored
bank. Well, we're into it now, and we'll do a site visit when it's over.
Core logs and armored bank, though. I mean, you're destroying that.
They don't have a time frame on that, right? We don't have any.
He wants to. I told him he's ready to.
He's ready to do it.
I don't know. He's ready to open in a couple of months. He's not going to get his occupancy until I sign off on it. I told him I'm not signing off on it until he can get his paperwork for a certificate of compliance. That's why 2 months before he's done, or 3 months before he's done, we're talking about these things. He's identified them, he wants to be on top of them, and we're moving forward. So
he
understands it.
That's a different strategy I hadn't heard. I mean, if he's gonna want to occupy and he can't because of that issue, then we have some leverage.
He better get those logs in pretty quick.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Like you're running out of growing season.
I can just imagine what those logs are going to look like, judging by the rest of the building and the site.
Just quickly, the milepost road, the neighbor's site next door, do we want to at least just contact them and see what they're doing back there?
No, I wrote them a letter. I thought you said go ahead and do it.
Okay, good. I want to make sure you did.
Oh.
Well, that's you already have that, you're way ahead of me.
This is where
good
the
job.
Neighbor's doing something?
Yeah, on their neighbor's, next door neighbor's land in theirs, is they, it looked like it had been grass, but now it is cut, grass is removed, it's all dirt, and it's a, you know, the cut's about 2 inches. Mm. So you know that it looks like it's going to be some landscaping.
Was it not like that when you guys were there?
We didn't notice.
You know what, we walked
like
in, we
shed.
Said this lot
he
looks
said.
Great, this is a really nice design. We didn't look at the neighbors.
You didn't go to it, did you?
No, we absolutely did.
You were watching
did.
TV.
We absolutely did.
They said, oh, I can
club.
See from Al's house.
We were up at Al's though. Drinking some beers. We said, it looks pretty good. Hey, give me those binoculars.
All right, caught.
All right, that's all I have.
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty obvious. What's this?
Was it behind the
I've
shed?
I've never seen anything dirt
yeah.
so well in my life.
I mean, it was like
perfect. It was like
it
a 3-inch
behind
patch.
The shed, but it was
awful. I went and looked at all
the
flags.
Whole yard.
Right out of there.
All the next door neighbor all along that.
Speaking of a perfect hole, what happened to the guy, the young kid with the deck that we thought was dug and his tank was back there and the wetlands is up there? Where's he been? Has it been before some 4 months?
That's Maple Street.
He only got a permit to put on siding. I don't know whatever happened to anything else. This really hasn't been talked about.
What happened is his footings in a deck there. That's what happened. That just popped in my head when he said perfect.
Hold He's on. Not going to build a deck. I mean, there's no way he can build a deck. I mean, if he does, it's going to be a big problem. He didn't strike me as that. He struck me as, I'll just concentrate somewhere else, and that's got to get done at some point, but I'm not going to do it right now.
Yeah.
Is the Salem Street project, is that done, do you think, for this season?
No.
They're still going to continue to work on that?
They're just away.
I know they're in Tibet, right?
Yeah, somewhere. I don't know where they're at.
I don't know
they're away.
Nepal.
Nepal, yeah.
Yeah.
And I did talk to Tom, and he said he's going to start doing some invasive removal.
There.
But as far as what's left, just the patio, really, and the planting and the fence.
I saw it's all walls back around where it was, and it's all straw.
It looked good?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it was graded, it, you know, you can't see what's under the straw. But I just assumed that they took all the stone dust and everything else out of there.
Did they take a tree?
You're right, I wasn't there for that part either, and no. I had gone by a couple of times, and they, when I went, so I went by one day, and then 2 days later went by again, and the straw was down. I'm like, oh, these guys are pretty quick. So I missed it, but even if that stone dust is down there and there's 3 inches over it and 3 or 4 or something yeah. like that, it'll be fine. So.
Any other issues, comments?
Oh, I have one more, another thing. That scout that was in here, so 20 Dean Road, remember the guy that was out there, did the pool? Well, he was sitting in the
he
back.
He was there, yeah.
Sitting in the back. He's a mentor for the scouts, and he said that if we provide him with a list of things that scouts could do as either community service work or scout projects, he would blend us in to, or do his best to blend us in to when the scouts are asking for Eagle Scout projects to get that work and to get that community service work. So I'm going to start, put a list together. I don't know if I'm going to do it tomorrow or Monday. But I'll send it out, and anything you know about, okay. you can say. So just my short list is going to be some of the signs in some of the swampy areas have fallen over. And, it, you know, I can't imagine what would be funner than to get out there and stand those babies right up.
Especially when it's dry.
Yeah, when it's dry like this. I mean, Matera Cabin sign needs to be painted. You know, those are good things. And, you know.
Did you want a boardwalk?
I asked them, I was going to ask them to adopt Pinevale. Mm. And to see if someone would kind of look at that as, you know, a place where they yeah. could walk through every once in a while and, you know, keep the traffic up in there. But
yeah, it doesn't seem like there's a lot of traffic in there. No. That trail is
it's a little gloomy in there. It's
overgrown.
I think if you were by yourself and scared of dogs, you might not.
Becky ran out of this kid.
Yeah, I didn't want to run into
scared of dogs?
Homeless people.
Just
camping
it
out.
It just doesn't.
Where were the dogs?
It's not welcoming. Yeah. No, I mean, if you're, like, I don't, like, I have a really big scar where the dog named Killer bit me when I was a kid, so I'm a little wary.
It doesn't mention it was the Chihuahua.
No, it was a white German Shepherd.
What's the name of that dog?
Lucy.
No, 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 the other one, the tiny little one, it was like
Rocco.
Rocco, yeah.
Rocco.
Rocco, if you're scared of Killer.
Rocco was 3
Rocco
pounds.
It is.
Some small dogs. The vet says that they don't know they're small and they have more testosterone than the larger dogs.
Yeah.
And this was a Yorkie.
Little dogs. I had a little Shih Tzu. He thought he was a pit bull.
But yeah, you run into, you know, I just don't feel like Pinevale is that. It doesn't feel welcoming. It's gloomy. Just that where you park, it's a lot of growth.
Well, that's gloomy.
The, you know,
and
the,
walking through
well,
there.
That could be another project, try to straighten out that front area. And there's another sign there that needs to be repaired.
That and I think the, I mean, if there's a way to get the Japanese knotweed out, I don't know how to get, I mean, that stuff.
That says you're first going in. It's not.
It's no, it goes far in there. There's a lot of invasives in there. It's a mess. And it so you feel crowded in. I think about my wife going into a place like that. She wouldn't feel great about that because just the visibility isn't great.
Now everybody's run out of steam. Okay. Do we have a
motion? Anything else?
Nope. Do we have a motion
to get the heck out of here?
I'll second.
All those in favor?